Good morning and welcome to the 14th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda this morning is to begin hearing oral evidence on the Scottish Languages Bill at Stage 1. And we have two panels of witnesses joining us today. And can I welcome our first panel? And thank you very much for joining us. And can I ask start by asking our witnesses, I hate using that word, but to introduce themselves and say which organisations that they are representing. And can we start with Donald on the left? Thanks.
Matthew Vatt, Tonishibi Kolarav. I'm Donald MacLeod. I'm Chief Officer for Education and Children's Services with Cónaí Níl an Siar, but my presence here today is specifically for the Association of Directors of Education Scotland, ADES, the group I'm representing.
Thank you.
Matthew Vatt, Tapalibson Horam Shaw. My name is Sean Charity, and I'm here representing Cómaí Lochtéigeach Arscoiltean, which is the Gaelic Secondary Teachers Association. I'm also a Gaelic teacher at Highland Council.
Thank you. And Bruce?
Thank you very much. Good morning. My name is Bruce Johnson. I'm here from Education Scotland, where I work as the Scots Language Coordinator.
Thank you. And finally?
Martin Vagouif. I'm Joan Essen. I work with Education Scotland and I'm an HM inspector.
Okay, thank you. And can I also formally note apologies from Stephanie Callaghan this morning. We are going to move directly into questions from the members. And can I first bring in Pam Duncan-Glancy, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to you all. Thank you for joining us. In the submission that has been submitted from the Inspectorate, we've said that the bill focuses on Gaelic language in isolation of interconnected factors that strengthen languages such as socio-economic challenges, and that from a national perspective, Gaelic needs considered across policy. So can I ask, maybe Joan first, if that's okay, in your view, is the scope of this bill wide enough?
As an Inspectorate, we welcome this legislation. We see that the legislation will bring change, it will bring impact. We see that happening through the strategy that's been proposed and also the reporting that's taking place via Borna Gaelic, and also the strengthening of existing provisions around the 2010 Act and also around the definition of education. We are an evidence-based organisation. We're always looking for impact. We're looking for working across organisations. And we're seeing that in the improved leadership of Gaelic within Scotland since the inception of Gaelic medium education. We're seeing leadership from government, from local government, from schools, from senior leaders, from Gaelic organisations, from national organisations as well. So we would see the continued approach there of working together, collectively working together, working across policy, so Gaelic is always considered to be a very important aspect of taking this legislation forward.
Thank you. So in your view then, do you think that the focus on education specifically is enough to do what it needs to do, and in particular to address the urgency that's required that you speak about in your submission?
Yeah. So we do see that the strategy, the legislation will have impact, but we also note the standards and the secondary legislation that sits with this bill. Mm-hmm. And we see things in that secondary legislation that are very important to shift Gaelic, to get more impact. So we're very interested in seeing these things taken forward as well. And indeed, we recognise these things as issues, challenges, successes that we find in our inspection findings as well. So that would help impact further in relation to the legislation.
Thank you. And just my final question from you, and then I have a question for Donald. How do you think this fits with wider reforms in education?
The wider reform is a Scottish Government agenda, and we're always looking for the very, very best for Gaelic and for Gaelic to keep a pace. Obviously, Gaelic medium education is a less mature system. We're still building the system up, so our expectations, our steps, the actions that we take for Gaelic will be bespoke to the sector, and also might look different to the English sector as well.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Donald, if it's okay, I'll come to yourself. Thank you. We've just heard briefly that the standards that the bill looks to include could be quite important in terms of education in Gaelic. Can you tell me a little bit about how your members feel about this and how they will approach Gaelic education going forward?
Thank you. Firstly, in terms of the association, it broadly welcomes the spirit of the legislation and the understanding of the priorities it's aiming to achieve. And as has been recognised, the standards are in themselves included in the bill, and there is a degree of concern amongst our members that we would like to be able to have an understanding of what the proposed standards are, how they're going to be measured, identified, and what accountability local authorities and education authorities within that will hold across the country in terms of both Gaelic and Scots.
And have your members been quite involved with the development of the proposals in the bill?
To differing degrees, yes. Some authorities such as my own, where we have a strong presence of Gaelic and Gaelic medium education, we have had greater degrees of involvement. But by the very nature of the subject at hand, it's a diverse picture across the nation. And as such, as an organisation, we have quite different views and differing degrees of involvement in both Gaelic and Scots.
And do you think that Gaelic education, and specifically what the bill proposes, including on standards, is enough to arrest some of the decline in the Gaelic language?
I think as a membership, we have some concerns in terms of the detail of the bill and how it's going to lead to change and how it's going to be measured and what the accountability on education authorities will be. But there is recognition that the bill is important in taking forward and arresting the decline in language and giving greater prominence and urgency to supporting the provision of education, particularly in languages, not just in the formal medium education as a first language learning, but also in for whole communities in learning these languages as a second language. So yes, we think the bill is important and is heading in the right direction, but we are concerned about the granular detail and the measurement and the aspects of accountability that education authorities will have that our membership feel needs to be more clearly defined.
Thank you. I have one final question, if that's okay, Convener. Thank you. My question is about, probably still for yourself, Donald, if that's okay. The policy memorandum lists quite a number of areas that the standards will need to make comment on, including access to provision, the access to Gaelic medium education as a 3-18 experience, subject choice, teacher and pupil support and resources, class sizes. All of this is highlighted as needing to be addressed. What will your organisation and your members need in order to do all of these things?
Yeah, we absolutely recognise that, and that comes back to some degree to my earlier response. We need, first of all, clarity on what the detail of the standards are, the expectations that education authorities will have in terms of implementing the standards, how they'll be measured, evaluated, and what potential negative consequences as an education authority may hold if standards are not met. And I think these are important things to be really clearly defined. Overall, there are some, again, it's a very diverse picture as a national organisation representing the 32 local authorities, and it's a very broad and different picture across the nation. In an authority such as my own, where Gaelic is, it's very much a heartland, we welcome that and feel that we can very confidently move forward with it. But there's other authority members are concerned about that they feel there's likely sufficient legislation already in the 2016 Act to address the growth of Gaelic medium education, and are concerned about potential imposition of standards that their community don't aspire to. So it's just that diverse picture across the nation that we try to capture in an act for that's going to cover the whole of Scotland.
Thank you. Thank you.
Questions in there? I'm uncertain if you wish to comment, Shawnee, at all on any of those.
I suppose on the standard side of things, what we would like to see, as we detailed in our written response, is a greater focus nationally on ensuring that Gaelic medium education is a 3-18 experience, because I think, as you can see from some of the stats we've submitted, that to all intents and purposes, in many schools, GME ceases to be a thing at the end of S2 or S3, depending on the subject choices. And if you're to consider Gaelic as a literacy subject, which it is with parity with English, that wouldn't be allowed to happen for English medium education, that pupils would be able to leave the subject without a qualification or without developing fluency or competence in the language. And so I think an important part of the standards will be setting that expectation that we're investing a lot of money and we have excellent numbers of pupils in Gaelic primary medium education. What is happening when they go into secondary school, and how are we ensuring that we're maximising the potential that exists with the numbers in primary school growing as they are? Are we converting that into fluent speakers? I don't know if we're going to come to this later on.
I hope so. I think we will. Yeah, that's great. Can I just, I mean, obviously there's some questions specifically about Gaelic and there'll be some about Scots, but if anyone wants to come in and after a question's been directed specifically to you and you want to, please catch my eye. All right, I've got a lot to juggle with some of the hybrid nature today. But thank you very much. And can I now come to questions from Ruth McGuire, please?
Thank you, Convener Mattenva. We've covered a fair bit in those first bits of questioning. I just want to drill in a little. So would the panel, or members of the panel, agree that there's a need to increase the focus of local authorities on Gaelic medium education? I was interested in, forgive me, Donald MacLeod's response there, that there's 32 local authorities will have differing views. Can you say a bit more? You said that they thought there was enough in existing legislation.
I think that's a challenge in terms of an organisation that represents the 32 local authorities, education authority representatives. And within my own authority in Corlin Yellin Shear, we would absolutely welcome the strengthening of this and the additional provisions that the new bill proposes. But there are challenges in that across the nation where maybe there aren't particular histories of involvement in Gaelic medium education or in Scots for that matter. But overall, there is a recognition of welcoming the legislation, but some membership feel that there is sufficient provision in the 2016 Act in terms of parents wishing to seek Gaelic medium education, that the functions are there to allow it to do it. I recognise that the bill aims to reduce the bureaucracy and simplify the process that parents want to be able to pursue establishing Gaelic medium education provision for their children. So it's a complex answer. It's not a straight yes or no, because I think it is a diverse picture depending on the history of the communities that our local authorities work within and what they aspire to achieve.
Okay, thank you. And Seanie, you spoke there about the need for 3 to 18 education and rightly pointed out that that's not available everywhere. Do you think that the focus should be on having that from early years right to secondary in maybe fewer locations, or what would the view be from?
I think what we would like to see at CLASS is a national roadmap which has destinations depending on the levels of development. So as Donald's just said, lots of local authorities might not have GME provision at this point in time. Lots of authorities might have had GME for 20 or 30 years. And so the ideal situation for us, I think, would be that there would be a staggered progression. This is where you start with GME, and this is how you progress. And for more advanced, for want of a better word, local authorities, you might have a clearer direction of travel in terms of the subjects that are being offered throughout secondary school, and that you might have more planning and support around the provision of resources for those subjects. So I think that's what we are alluding to with the acknowledgement that some local authorities don't have Gaelic medium or Gaelic learners education, and that targets and progression would be appropriate to the stage of that authority is at.
And is there any concern that where we try to do a little bit everywhere, that actually in terms of lifting the language and protecting it, that's maybe not the most effective thing to do?
I think what I'd say to that is that it's important to remember that Gaelic belongs to everyone in Scotland and that everyone should have the opportunity to engage with the language. That being said, there are more some communities, for example, where Don's from, that have a more historic connection with the language, and that you might seek to further augment what is happening in that local authority with respect to the opportunities presented in schools. But I think it would be a dangerous line to go down creating tiers of expectations based on historic and community traits or features or history. So I think it's it's difficult to provide a one-size-fits-all response to each authority, but that it's important to take note of where they are and what could be done in various steps.
Donald.
I might have just mentioned as well another factor that our membership has spoken about, which is trying to keep strength within the bill, but to also try and keep hold of local decision-making as much as is possible. That's something that I think is really important for us to keep hold of, just again in recognition of the diverse nature of language learning across the nation and the prevalence of different languages in different communities. So trying to keep a hold of the power to have local decision-making through local authorities, but also to respect the aspiration of setting standards nationally. And there is a wee bit of rub between setting national standards and keeping local decision-making, respecting the position of local authorities. So it is a difficult balance.
You probably know what I'm going to ask you now. Is there something in the bill that needs to change to get that balance right?
I think it's maybe trying to have more recognition within the bill of the ability to have some local decision making around it, and to maybe have maybe for me it comes back to the detail of the standards, so that it may be having adaptive standards that allow us to have focused measures in different communities reflecting where they're at in their journey towards developing language. That may be an area where we could recognise local context and the duties and responsibilities of local authorities to meet that in a local setting, just to, again, recognising that diversity across the nation and the different nuances of where the history of Gaelic medium education is and where the diversity of Scots is across the authorities that more influences.
Yeah.
And just to come back on that very quickly, I appreciate what Don's saying, and with the caveat that historically, if you look at local authority provision, it's very, very patchy. And so I appreciate the need to have a balance, but there's also an inherent risk in that you're then depending on individual officers and local authorities making decisions about Gaelic medium education and Gaelic learners' education. And that's why we would be pushing for clearer expectations and clearer standards. But I appreciate Don's point about the diversity of authorities.
Okay. That's fine, Jeanette. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much. And Ben McPherson now, please.
Thank you very much, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Just building on the previous questions and your answers thus far, I just wondered if you could give me your view on whether you support the proposal for Scottish ministers to set standards for Gaelic education.
Donald, your microphone's been switched on, so it's going to be you.
I guess that's me then. Ultimately, yes, and picking up on what Shawnee's last response was, there's no opposition to standards, but the point being that we feel that these standards need to be carefully defined in the bill, because local authorities who will be accountable need to understand both the standards themselves in detail, in the granular detail, how they're going to be measured and what the ultimate accountability for them is. So there isn't an opposition to the standards in and of themselves, but there is a wish for more detail about what they will contain and how they will be measured and evaluated.
I think, well, what we tried to make clear in our written submission is that the current approach isn't working very well in terms of the output we're getting at the end of Gaelic secondary education. And so I know I've read lots of written responses and discussions about what it means to be fluent in Gaelic, and a National 5 qualification doesn't necessarily guarantee that, and there's a lot of work to be done in that respect, which maybe come back to. But if we look at what has been invested in Gaelic medium education so far, and the number of pupils achieving qualifications, it's not an efficient process. And particularly if you look at Gaelic learners, it's taken a nosedive. And to the point that it's an existential threat as a qualification. And luckily, we have very supportive officers at SQA who are willing to keep pushing and promoting the subject. But we are in a position where we've let things grow organically, and you have a very much postcode lottery across Scotland in terms of whether your child is going to achieve a qualification in Gaelic, whether the structure of the curriculum and the course choice structure facilitates them achieving a qualification in Gaelic. And so I think the types of standards we'll be looking for are things that support the development of fluency, achieving a qualification and all of those things, and that it is clear to everyone involved in GME that the expectation is that pupils continue with Gaelic and gain a qualification in the language and an ability and competency in the language, given that they are, in many ways, the lifeline of the Gaelic Development Project.
wondering if Joan wanted to...
Do you want to come in, Joan?
We see the setting of standards by Scottish ministers as a way of improving the current situation, encouraging it to be more strategic, to also have better operational criteria and also better governance around it. We do understand that it needs to be driven by data and where there is interest and demand, and that we're using the data to highlight and to remove barriers within Gaelic. We also appreciate that there would need to be collaboration between education authorities, between parents, between teachers, between national and local organisations. And the way we see the standards and the description of the standards written in the accompanying papers, we see the potential there for the standards to be driving that change.
Thank you. Bruce, did you want to add anything to that? Or?
On speaking specifically about Scots?
Sorry, please excuse me.
Apologies, just for a very small point in terms of the standards and building on what Joan has pointed out. I think, and looking at the standards, it's important that they focus on quality and quantity. There's a concern about, and has been particularly in the history of Gaelic medium education, has sometimes been about measures of quantity, which are in and of themselves important, but that we have measures of quality of provision within there too.
And just following on from those answers, and thank you, that was helpful to hear your views. I'm also interested to hear your views, and we are, on the operation of the statutory process in requesting GME in primary schools. And what are your views on this being extended to include Gaelic medium ELC? And should there be a right to Gaelic medium education? And with a Gaelic medium education primary school in my constituency, I know some of these issues firsthand. I don't know, Mr. Charity, if you wanted to come in on that, because it kind of feeds back to some of your other points in the previous answer.
I think, as you heard last week and in a lot of the written responses, it's a source of great disappointment that the right to GME hasn't been included in this in the way that people might have hoped for. And we support the idea in principle, absolutely. I think we would caution that the situation we're in at the moment with staffing, recruitment and particularly retention of Gaelic medium teachers calls for much more rigorous and urgent action. I can't remember off the top of my head, but the latest teacher census had 418 Gaelic primary teachers able to teach through medium of Gaelic, but only 266 currently working in Gaelic medium education. So there's a big question there about why are these people who are capable of teaching Gaelic not working in Gaelic medium education? What does that mean for the future progression and any right to GME that might be included in the bill? But as I said at the start, I think for our members it's a source of great disappointment, and we'd be very, very keen to see that.
Joan or Donald, did you want to add anything on those points?
As an inspector, we're involved in the 2016 process, and what we have found is that it gives parents a process to speak to local authorities about setting up Gaelic medium education at primary one. So we'd very much see the process extending to early learning and childcare as a positive step. We would see it helping attainment and helping children make better progress, improving their fluency. There is a process that parents would contact, would discuss with local authority, and it would be a decision for them to come to in relation to whether that would be taken forward. But we would see it as beneficial to have that for early learning and childcare as well, so that there is more equity between what we have in English medium and in Gaelic medium education. In relation to rights, my colleagues referred to rights for parents. parents are very committed to Gaelic medium education. When they make that choice, they are looking for quality, they are looking for high standards, and that's our role in inspection, to be quality assuring, to be involved in that process. There's also a right for children and for them also to be experiencing that quality, progressive, coherent journey through Gaelic medium education. So we would see that also coming from the learner perspective as something that would be important going forward.
Thank you.
Yes. Again, initially from the personal perspective from Colonial and Shear, where we have had Gaelic ELCs for quite a considerable amount of time, and in some instances Gaelic and English medium ELCs sitting side by side. The provision of Gaelic medium ELC is a massive driver of onwards uptake of Gaelic medium primary education and a key foundation stone of that 3 to 18 Gaelic pathway. And I think it is a really important consideration of the bill to include ELC where the ask is there, particularly around the very beginnings of the acquisition of oral language that goes on in their ELC settings. And as I say, that driver of future uptake of Gaelic medium education, it absolutely starts people on a positive path towards Gaelic education, and it's a really important first step in engaging parents and supporting that journey, and as Joan says, they're always very passionate to do so. In terms of ADES and the ask about the strengthening of the legislation for provision of Gaelic medium education provisions, be they ELC, primary or otherwise, it's just the caution again of making sure that there is genuine, sustainable and resourced demand there, and that it creates viable provisions where there's a genuine need for them to be established, and not necessarily a side effect of the legislation becoming that requirements are imposed on authorities where there isn't a sustainable demand.
We've got questions about teachers.
We do, so yes. And we're going to go online now to bring in our colleague Willie Rennie. He's got some questions. Thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. Actually, if I can just go to Donald, first of all, to respond to the point earlier on made by, I think it's pronounced Shoney, about why, when teachers are qualified in to teach Gaelic, that they're not teaching that subject in the schools. Why does he think that's happening? What research has been done?
I think it was actually to me in the first instance. And my response has to be to some degree anecdotal on that, because we don't have access immediately to widespread research on the matter. But I can speak again specifically from Colonial and Shear and our experience of that, where we have Gaelic medium education in almost every school that we operate. And in terms of the very specific answer to the question, the biggest single driver we see to teachers who are capable of delivering Gaelic medium education and not is about confidence in their own language ability. And it's something that we've been trying to address as a local authority to help support teachers who have degrees of fluency in Gaelic that require support, professional development, professional learning to help them, and very often in cases of just having confidence as much as increasing their actual skills to take the step into Gaelic medium education. And we have supported quite a number of our own staff to do that. So as it stands at the moment in Colonial and Shear, we have a healthy provision of Gaelic medium education primary teachers. I can't say the same in the context of secondary, but in answer to the specific question, it's predominantly trying to make sure that there is a support network there for staff to take that step and make sure that their confidence in the language is sufficient to take the step into Gaelic medium education. Because the support for it is genuinely there, but there can be a concern about their fluency in grammar, a concern about their accuracy of spelling, the detail of the language, which is a personal confidence thing, but they want to make sure that when they're teaching it to others, that they're getting it right.
And are you making progress on that front? Are you managing to keep some of them in the classroom?
Locally within Colonial and Shear, yes, absolutely we have. And we have used a combination of local resources, supporting teachers through team teaching and mentoring, and also supporting teachers to work on the Gaelic Acquisition for Teachers programme as well.
I don't know if Shoney wants to come in and maybe just give his perspective.
I think a very interesting paper to read is it's a bit more than just teaching, which was written in 2015. I think it was referenced in one of the Solmore responses, which describes the role of a Gaelic teacher, and it is above and beyond just teaching in the classroom. You're an ambassador for the language. In many cases, people are creating resources and working hand to mouth with teaching materials and things like that. And so I'd break it down into three key areas. And again, this is based on my own perceptions. That's down to professional learning. So Gaelic medium immersion teachers don't necessarily have the access to enough specialist professional development, which equips them to be able to teach a diverse range of learners in the classroom. We have emerging now excellent programmes like the Solmore Austic Masters in Gaelic Education, which is, and I know people doing the course and are very, very strong in the praise of the course. But again, that is a master's degree that teachers are doing in their spare time. So it's not necessarily suitable for all Gaelic teachers. I think it's been widely discussed the lack of additional support needs staff and guidance for Gaelic medium education, and with increasing class sizes in primary schools across the country, that becomes more of an issue, whereas perhaps in previous years we've had smaller numbers in primary classes, and that's been more manageable for a teacher. However, now we're in a position where we have composite classes, but perhaps more bigger numbers in composite classes or just full primary classes, and trying to deal with that. And then it comes down to the resourcing thing in terms of things like PSAs, classroom assistants and things like that, and that is In some authorities, it's a real struggle to get Gaelic-speaking staff who can support in the classroom. And I think all of those things add to the it's a privilege, but it's a burden of being a Gaelic teacher, particularly at the primary stage.
Do you want to come back in?
Yeah. I just want to make maybe one other point as well, in building on what Johnny has said there. Do you have a really robust and deep and high-quality Gaelic immersive experience in a school? It obviously, teachers are the fundamental resource, but we need Gaelic-speaking staff across the system. And as has been said by Seanie, the PSA support assistants, admin staff, clerical workers, ELC staff. We're trying to grow the Gaelic population across that whole staff population. And another related challenge to that is, as has been mentioned, around ASN staff, which is important in the school, but it's also having Gaelic-speaking staff in our support services around school, NHS speech and language therapists, for instance, having access to Gaelic-speaking staff that are part of the holistic team supporting children.
Could I come back in again, just briefly?
Of course, Willie.
The in a previous evidence session, not related to this bill, we heard evidence that sometimes those in traditional Gaelic-speaking areas, they're not able to recruit sufficient teachers in the language because many of them are going off to the Central Belt to a different life, but still within Gaelic medium education. Is there a danger that if we expand it elsewhere, that the language is undermined in its heartland?
Donald. Absolutely. There's no doubt that's a reality in some degree. And as one of these authorities, we have seen a two-way movement in that, to be fair. We have lost some of our staff to the attractions of larger authority areas and city areas where they can have other aspects of their wider life, but still be able to teach in Gaelic medium education. But something that and has been a benefit to us within that too is regaining them back. And recruiting them back into our system again. So we've got quite a number of Gaelic medium education teachers now who have been and worked in other authorities and, as it were, come back home. And that's been of benefit to us in terms of their widened experience and the skill sets that they have gained and brought back to us. And there's no doubt that it's, as Gaelic will grow and as we all hope it will, there's no doubt that will become an increasingly competitive market, but that is the same as an English medium and Gaelic medium, and it's just working with the initial teacher education authorities and the training bodies to try and make sure we are as best as possible matching supply and demand. And as I say, for ourselves just now, Gaelic medium education primary teachers is not too much of an issue. We've been working on growing our own programme as well, with partnering with UHI. But trying to meet that demand in secondary education has been a much more considerable challenge for us and continues to be. So there definitely needs to be a look as part of the implementation of the bill about how we manage the workforce and the resources around that.
Thank you.
Very briefly, just to make the point that it's also tied up in socio-economic issues that affect Highlands and Islands in a number of ways, and most notably housing, and how difficult that can be for particularly teachers in early stages in their career to find housing in rural areas. And just to pick up on what Donald said, that the grow-your-own approach has been used very successfully in Western Isles, but also in Skye, where Solmore have an initiative where pupils from the school can go to the college and learn a bit more about being a teacher at that early stage, so capturing people young and cementing that idea that there's a career, there's a pathway for people to stay in rural areas and be successful and go on to do and contribute to Gaelic education as a whole.
Thanks. Thank you. Bill Kidd, you've got a supplementary on this. Thanks.
Yes, thanks very much for all the evidence. I've just in Glasgow, of course, there's the Gaelic school in the West End, and it's a very big school. It takes them in from very early age right through. But there's actually more than teaching staff there. I mean, there's support staff and all sorts of others who work there. But they do it all, of course, in the Gaelic medium and speech and etc. But some of them have been under pressure in terms of job stability on that basis. And I was just wondering if that's the same across the country, because I was hoping it isn't. But I do know of people who have maybe been on two, three-year contracts, who their contracts they're running out and there's no intention to actually extend those. Is that the same across Scotland?
Yeah, I'll maybe begin, thank you. I would say it is echoed in many authorities across Scotland, because we are all working with one-year budgets, be they one-year budgets within local authorities or one-year budgets in terms of grant funding that's available to support Gaelic medium education. And there's certainly been a degree of discussion about trying to create financial security in the system to allow for longer term planning and security of employment for not just the core teaching staff but all staff across provisions. So it's a huge challenge for local authorities across the nation that are challenged in their budgets and in their security of funding to support the language education. And it's definitely a concern that runs through the bill about resourcing the growth that we hope that the bill will achieve, because there are challenges of resourcing the existing provision as well.
Thank you. And Shoni?
Yeah, I think it's probably fair to say that's an issue across Scotland, but I would say it's something that permeates education as a whole, the short-term contract thing, and it's as damaging to Gaelic as it is to any other subject, having high numbers of teachers on short-term contracts and the effect that has on stability and continuity of education in any subject area, in any context.
Okay. Joan?
Just to add to what my colleagues are saying there, we do see creative ways of supporting staffing across the country and extending contracts, trying to have full-time contracts is important in attracting staff, as is looking at some of the barriers in particular areas like housing. So we see local authorities supporting teachers with the likes of housing. We also see the promotion of technology, where teaching is delivered through technology to support staffing, to extend the range of areas that Gaelic medium can be delivered. And we also see some creative use of promotional structures as well, where it's maybe been difficult for a local authority to recruit. We've been in one of these schools in the last inspection year, where to increase and attract, they've looked at how to make the job more attractive by looking at advertising something as a principal teacher, for example. And beyond the areas that my colleagues have spoken to, we've also seen this idea of growing your own, where young people who have been in Gaelic medium education are returning to Gaelic medium education to teach in schools, to take up various roles within the school. And that's always a success of the system, to be able to see that.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Is that okay? Just let me check with Willie's wanting to come in on any thread there. No. Donald, back to yourself.
Thank you. It was just a quick point, just building on what Joan said there, and I think the committee heard a little last week about eSchool, which is a provision that was developed in my own authority over a number of years and has had significant Scottish Government support, and the genesis of which was in addressing teacher shortage and demand in Gaelic particularly, and has grown to do other things since. And it has had huge support and real success in terms of how it supports the language and digital teaching in Gaelic. But it is challenged particularly in terms of what's ultimately outmoded teacher conditions of service that we need to work actively with trade unions to try and address and open up the massive potential that we have for expanding digital learning and getting digital teaching online. And that's something I think we need to work more strategically across the nation to support.
Excellent, thank you. Earlier on, Donald, you spoke about a deep and immersive experience, is how important that is when you're in the school. Shauna, you spoke about the support staff and the holistic nature that's needed of the services coming in and the challenges of those people not speaking Gaelic. But I was wondering, what are local authorities and others doing to support pupils to use Gaelic outside of the school environment? Wondering if you could perhaps think about that. Donald, first.
Okay, yep, my light is on.
Sorry, your light is on, I know.
It's okay. We are coming down. I think it's been the point that's been made as well that Gaelic doesn't exist only in the classroom, and it fundamentally isn't going to survive if it only exists inside the classroom. It's a community language and it has to have genuine presence and genuine use across the community. And I'm fortunate in my own local authority that there are real genuine Gaelic heartlands there and fantastic community work happening across the area. And I think it's important what the bill is aiming to do in terms of areas of linguistic significance in relation to that. For me, what's important to recognise in there is real life and meaningful opportunities to engage with the language. Some of the most successful things we've done there have been things like intergenerational projects, working with community organisations to bring Gaelic speakers into schools or bring schools to the Gaelic speakers, and working directly with communities on special interest projects, local historical contexts, working with historical societies, and making sure that there's real live connections between the language that they're learning in the school and the way that they're using it in communities. And there's the kind of formal aspects of that where it's planned and structured, but also trying to create more informal opportunities through community events, ceilidhs, performances. And I think that's where it joins up the language with culture and music, which are fundamental aspects of the wider Gaelic culture. And these applications of the language are really fundamentally important in securing the future. So I welcome what the bill is trying to do to try and make sure that the language does move beyond the learning context, and feel that it's really important in terms of securing the future of the language and giving young people a sense of value. And probably another thread quite importantly connected to that is that socioeconomic activity and the value of Gaelic for young people going through the 3-18 pathway and into further learning and work, and that Gaelic is seen as an asset that could be a distinguishing factor between them and somebody else, where there are huge opportunities for some of the things we've mentioned around education, but in many other sectors where Gaelic could be a huge strength and an asset, and coming away from some of the more typical routes into the likes of the media, which are still valid, but also into health and social care and supporting communities and many jobs across particularly our island communities, which then feeds in really importantly to population retention and keeping hold of our young people to be living, working, learning, earning in our own communities.
Very
Sorry
helpful.
For the long-winded
No,
answer.
That was very helpful. There were some useful examples there as well, which was what we always like to get. I've got Joan wanted to come in, and I suspect Shauna will want as well. Thank you, Joan.
Yeah. So I would like to highlight here that this is where we are seeing impact of where we have advice just now and also existing statutory guidance in relation to immersion. We are evidencing that there's a much better understanding across the country in our schools about immersion and how it's very important to have this very strong immersion experience in school, but also to be using Gaelic, learning Gaelic, sustaining Gaelic, also out with the classroom and out with the school as well. So we are seeing community work, we are seeing partnership working, we are seeing intergenerational working, we are seeing adult learning working, and all of that joins up and increases children and young people's opportunities to be using Gaelic. Another important aspect is that there are Gaelic learning opportunities for all children in the school where we have Gaelic and English medium together. That increases as well the opportunities to be using Gaelic and to be increasing the immersive experiences and to be giving children and young people themselves responsibility for using their language. So that's an area where we are seeing growth, but we're also looking for more connection in the use of accreditation, looking for more joint working across partners so that we can increase that further.
That's great. Thank you, Joan and Shona. Apologies.
I would support all of what has been said by Donald and Joan, and it's a really crucial part of developing fluency in Gaelic. And I frame my thinking on this, and there's a linguist economist who talks about the capacity, opportunity, desire model, and that is if you want people to use a minority language, you need to have those three things in place. So you need to have the capacity, i.e. that pupils are able to talk in Gaelic fluently. They have the opportunities to do that, and then they have the desire to do that. And I think we can discuss curriculum and how you do the first two, but the opportunities are one of the key things that pupils need. And as a teacher working in a high school, we benefit greatly from the work done by Comina Gaelic, who have regular meetings with our pupils, Film G, Sports Gaelic, FC Saunas. There's actually a rich landscape in terms of opportunities for school pupils, and as my work as a board member of Born in Gaelic as well, see the range of youth work that is going on throughout the country, and that's really a really positive thing to see. And yeah, it's absolutely vital that that continues and grows along with GME as a whole.
Okay, thank you. Now I'm going to ask a question that's for all four members of the panel as we start to move more into a section on Scots, Bruce, so get ready. So how has Gaelic and Scots been supported through the 1+2 policy approach, and how has that helped? Can we start with you, Bruce, if that's okay?
Yeah, thank you very much. Yeah, so Scots is very popular as an L3 language in the 1+2 strategy. To be an L2 language, you have to be able to sit a higher, so there's numerous languages that only become L3 options, and Scots is one of the most popular choices outside of those L2 options, along with British Sign Language. Scots is spoken across Scotland, so all 32 local authorities have the opportunity to include Scots language learning in their curriculum, as well as the more traditional Scots literacy lessons. Mm-hmm. And Scots has so many links to other modern European languages, French and Dutch and German and Gaelic and English, that it's a great source of information that the bairns in schools recognise and can make links to. And it links so much to other areas of the curriculum that Scots language has been a very popular feature of the 1+2 policy thus far.
Okay, thank you. Does anyone else? Donald?
Yes, L1+2 has been really important in raising the prominence of language learning generally within the school setting. And again, personal experience, that for Gaelic sitting as a second, as L2, for children who are coming into school into English medium has been a really important focus area for making sure that there's a pathway for young people to reach the curriculum aspirations and curriculum requirements of Gaelic as a learner language. I think there is still a lot of work for us to do there, and I think a lot of our schools, the focus has been rightly so and significantly on Gaelic medium education as a first language, but we need to make sure that there's a really robust language 2 pathway within Gaelic for those who are not in Gaelic medium education. So Language 2 has been a very important Gaelic as a Language 2 has been an important platform there for that within my own authority, but across the country as well. Gaelic has benefited from being a popular Language 2 choice, particularly right through the west coast of Scotland. And I think it may well be a Language 3 choice in other areas as well. So overall, I think it's been a positive, but in some areas we have more work to do to make sure that children are reaching their full entitlement.
Thank you. Joan, do you come in?
The benefits that we see of 1 plus 2 is that it's created a pathway for children in Gaelic medium education to be able to study more than one language, particularly in primary, so that there is a clearer route for them. This is an area that we would like more impact in, and this is an area where we would like to see more progression from primary 1 through to the senior stages. You mentioned earlier numbers for Gaelic learners and how these numbers were low. We talked about how do we sustain the language, how do we arrest decline, and this is one of the ways that we see potential for growing Gaelic and for having a stronger system within the school. It's something we report on, it's something that we set actions on with school, talk about areas for improvement. So we have various methods where we've been raising the need to look at better pathways for Gaelic learners in the curriculum.
Sorry, you said more impact. I'm trying to figure out what do you mean by that, sir, if that's possible.
So we'd like to see more children and young people in our schools doing Gaelic learners as part of 1 plus 2 or as part of existing statutory guidance in Gaelic. There is a part of that statutory guidance in Gaelic just now that encourages all children and young people to be learning Gaelic in schools. So we'd like to see more schools taking up that opportunity.
Thank you for that clarity. Seanie.
Thanks. As someone who delivered a lot of GLPS in James Gillespie's cluster primaries when I first started teaching, I think 1 plus 2 was fantastically beneficial in terms of spreading Gaelic to a wider community, and that in many ways, when it's been used effectively, has exposed huge numbers of young people to Gaelic and maybe piqued their interest in the language and potentially to push them to consider doing it further on in school. But I'd go back to the previous point about the numbers that we're seeing coming out at the end of the certification process. They're dwindling, and so you've got this contradiction in that you have a lot more people studying Gaelic at primary school and fewer achieving qualifications in secondary school and for Gaelic learners. And so whilst 1 plus 2, the sentiment of the programme has been excellent, I think in terms of how we ensure that progress continues into the senior phase, that's the key focus now, in ensuring that what's happening in primary schools continues to grow and develop, and that secondary, the structure of the curriculum and the provision in place allows for them to continue with that progress.
Thank you. Liam Kerr now, please. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Bruce Jensen, I'll come to you first. I'd like to move to part two of the bill on the Scots. I'm interested in how Scots can particularly be supported in education. Now, the submission, your submission, notes that you need a more detailed description of what Scots actually is, and the bill, in my view, slightly unhelpfully defines the Scots language as the Scots language. What is, in your view, the definition of the Scots language that professionals will need to be using? And if we accept that it's something of an all-encompassing term, incorporating various dialects, for example, Doric, is there an accepted definition of which dialects are included such that a teacher can be confident that she is teaching Scots?
It's an excellent question and an important detail that I was keen to address in the submission that I wrote on behalf of Education Scotland. I think the title of this bill, Scottish Languages, is particularly apt, therefore can include Gaelic, can include Scots, and whatever term that the speakers use and have used for centuries for their local branch of Scots in Aberdeenshire, it's Doric. We want the teachers in Aberdeen and Aberdeenshire to know that this bill means that they can carry on with their Doric teaching and that this bill represents the rights of Doric speakers. Same in Orkney with Arcadian, same in Shetland with the Shetland dialect. We want this bill to increase the rights for all speakers, whether it's the parents in the classroom, the parents at home, the teachers. Further awareness raising is going to need to be done so that the likes of the Orkney Islands Council submission says we're very proud about the work that we've done in our schools for generations using Orcadian, the links that it has to local culture, the way that it retains the population, engages the young people. So this bill has a bit more work to do on the definition of Scots language, but is certainly a real step forward in terms of getting all the areas and erts and perts of Scotland to respond with the good work that has been being done for generations in schools.
Yes, I understand. I appreciate colleagues may wish to come in, but so you would accept then that Scots language, as envisaged by this bill, is a catch-all term for various dialects, which will require to be promoted as that individual dialect in the individual area. Mm-hmm. Is there any way of defining exhaustively what those dialects are, or is there a certain level that a pattern of speech, if you like, requires to become a dialect?
Well, I think that the two speakers you had last week, Robert Miller from the Dictionaries, Michael Dempster from the Scots Language Centre, they've done an immense amount of work in this area, defining what the dialects are, where they are, what the unique features are, where vocabulary is the same across the dialects, where the vocabulary changes, where there's differences in terms of grammar used. But it certainly all comes together under the Scots language, and in terms of this bill, all comes under Scottish languages, languages unique to this country. And all 32 local authorities will have schools that use Scots in some form. They just might not be in the habit of calling it Scots. The speakers in Aberdeen will call it Doric. The speakers in Orkney will call it Orcadian. The speakers in Shetland will call it perhaps Shetland dialect or Shetlandic or just Shetland. But we want the bill to make sure that all local authorities, when you ask for their evidence on what they've been doing, that they all answer with the work that they have been doing. Perhaps it's unique to their dialect, perhaps they don't consider it Scots, and there's nothing wrong with that. Let's not attempt to redefine or rebrand speakers. Let's respect them wherever they are in Scotland and whatever name that they've been using for generations, but make sure that the bill makes it clear that we want to hear what work they've been doing, because the work they've been doing in schools has been fantastic from my experience of seeing it.
Very grateful. Joan Essen, we heard about the local authorities. No doubt local authorities, for whatever reason, are not flush with resources and cash at the moment. Now, when discussing Gaelic earlier, Donald said that one of the issues with Gaelic is that teachers are not confident. I think Donald just talked about confident spelling, and Shawnee talked about they're having to create resources. Joan Essen, are there existing resources on the Scots language in terms of grammar, in terms of the spelling and accepted words for each dialect that we've just heard about? Or will these require to be produced for each? And if so, who's going to do it and at what cost?
I'm happy to reply to that. It's work that we've already been doing. Again, it's been my approach at Education Scotland to create resources for individual dialects. But it's important to understand, so often the resource is the same. You just have different spellings and certain different features. But like anything, any good work that happens in education, the more prep and the hard work you put in at the start, the better the results are. Because the children in the class, they need to be addressed in a language that they recognise as their own. It can't be alien to them. It can't be a foreign concept that sounds like something from somewhere else. It needs to be the language that they use. And teachers mirror that approach as well. The work that I do with Sylvia Varnica at the Open University, training teachers for the first time in using Scots, they're very eager to write their lesson plans and adapt on each other's lesson plans. There's a real community in Scots language education, of teachers sharing work. and helping each other, giving each other resources, and then perhaps tweaking them in the same way that they do for every other subject in education. So many teachers take a resource that either exists from a central service or one of their peers and adapt it to suit the learners in front of them, the learners in their classroom. That's best practice in modern Scottish teaching. And I think that one of the best things about this bill is that we're really going to validate that. We're really going to give teachers confidence that what they've been doing is correct and that what they have the immense amount of skill in that they can carry on doing. That's something that's come out as a strong piece of evidence from the work that we've done training teachers and gathering evidence, gathering their views on how best Scots is used for the educational benefit of the children and young people in Scotland. And that's where they tailor it to meet the children in front of them, same as they do for all subjects.
So just to be clear, I'll just press you on that. So if this bill is brought in, will Education Scotland be producing the materials for each dialect, or is the expectation that the individual classroom teacher will be producing the materials to teach?
It's both. I create resources that sometimes are for unique dialects and create resources that have unique dialect elements in each one. And then individual teachers will then tailor that as they use their professional judgment to. And that's very common practice in education. The web stats team, Education Scotland, give me results on which resources have been the most popular on the website. And frequently, the most popular resource is a very simple one that we wrote years ago, and it's called 100 Scots Words, and it breaks it down into the different dialects. 100 Shetland words, 100 Orcadian words, 100 Doric words. And that's been the most popular resource ever, and it's actually a very simple resource. But you'll, I think, understand what I mean in terms of it validates that you don't need to worry about a central Scots. What's the Scots of the that's most spoken? It's okay to be unique. In fact, it chimes with the values of so many other education policies like the UNCRC and the linguistic rights of the child. It chimes with a policy such as GERFEC, getting it right for every child, that every child has unique qualities. They come together in areas of Scotland where those features are shared, and a teacher will recognise and address that, and that's where you see the best educational results when it comes to this.
Thank you. I wouldn't be surprised if the committee would appreciate that the data that you just talked about, as well as perhaps links to those resources. Donald, I'm going to throw the question to you, but Bruce, I suspect you'll want to stand ready because you may well come back in this. Shawnee was talking earlier on about difficulties perhaps training and recruiting Gaelic teachers and getting the Gaelic teachers to teach their specialism. Donald, just given something you said earlier, do you have any ideas around how we train teachers to deliver in their dialect of Scots and any indication of where might be offering places for this and indeed whether there's the demand from teachers?
I'm afraid it's not data I have available to me in terms of Scots language, I'm afraid. I know the position personally more specifically for Gaelic medium education, but not for Scots. Maybe Bruce is more able to answer in terms of provision for teaching in Scots.
Yeah, so as you'll have heard last week, Michael and also the civil servants, Douglas and Claire, spoke about the first ever teacher training course that's been created by Education Scotland, myself, and Open University. Sylvia Varnock will be speaking to you after 11. And this has been an ask of the profession for generations, that they get training specifically in using Scots in the classroom. An obvious reason for that demand is that we've changed a policy that Scots used to not be allowed. It used to be a language of the playground in the home, and then it's been allowed in the classroom. And teachers need support with that. They need training on that. So when we created this, teachers came to us and asked to sign up to study further. And I've also done an immense amount of work in Scottish universities for the ITE and PGDE courses, where people are training to be teachers, come along and give a lecture on how to use Scots in the classroom. And you'll be delighted to hear that it's met with a huge amount of enthusiasm, particularly the young people who have just finished school and perhaps were vaguely aware that this was something that they could have been doing more of. and they're immensely enthusiastic about teaching it more once they become their teachers, once they get their qualification and get a place in school. So I think that this bill is incredibly timely in giving validation to all those teachers who are eager and interested and giving them confidence that they can do this. And the training is very much about raising confidence, sharing resources, having a group of peers where you can work in a community and support each other. And that's what we've found from running the course thus far.
One very small thing on that. So when they're training in Scots, what are they training in? Like, are they training in Doric Scots or Orkney Scots, or how does that work?
Well, Sylvia and I, we don't dictate the Scots that they use. The teachers themselves either are already Scots speakers or they are new Scots speakers, just like learners in the classroom. So Scotland is a multilingual nation. The Scottish classroom is a multilingual space. And teachers are coming either as Scots speakers who have already, as part of their teaching profession, done some lessons and would like further support, or are teaching bairns who are Scots speakers and saying, I see the benefits that come from giving this a prominent place in the classroom. I want to develop my skills further. In terms of use of Scots, we leave it to them to recognise who in their classroom is going to benefit from the Scots that is in the room. And then they make decisions and get support from ourselves or from other partner organisations, the Dictionary, the Scots Language Centre, other teachers in the school. And to go back to this point of all the staff who work in a school, that might also be a janitor, a playground support worker, the head teacher themselves. You know, once the staff themselves are having a conversation about who speaks Scots in the school, so many hands start to go up and it mirrors the example in the classroom about, well, who here in the room speaks Scots and would like to use it more in their learning.
Very grateful. Convener.
Just briefly on that then, Bruce, as well. So how the Scots language standards that are spoken of in the legislation bill, how could they be used to support greater use of Scots?
I think that this bill, I think the immediate effect is this validation, and then from there confidence, and then comes increased numbers. We just spoke about 1+2. I think a further effect of this bill is we'll see more Scots being done as part of 1+2, with Scots being chosen as an L3 language by schools, because it's another language that teachers have skills in. Scots is a sister language to English, and it's also a language spoken all around us. Teachers will want to harness the Scots that's used in the classroom and see the educational benefits flourish. And if we continue down a longer road in terms of progression, if we get more Scots qualifications, Scots might also be an option at an L2 and see its role in 1+2 develop even further. So I think that in terms of, you know, what the 32 local authorities can report on, that point about understanding what they're being asked, is Orkney Islands Council being asked to report on Scots? And they say, we're not sure if we do that, or they maybe say we don't. But if they're being asked to report on what they do with Orcadian and the Orkney dialect, then they'll have an immense amount to report on. And we'll see that all 32 local authorities are keen to build on that. And with support of myself and the other organisations you've heard from, I think that we'll see the education benefits for the children and young people increase year on year.
Thank you, Bruce, for that. Can I now come to questions from Bill Kidd, please?
Thank you, convener. I think this will be addressed mostly at Bruce, but in terms of when I was at school, you would be ridiculed or given the belt for speaking Scots, and then you'd be taken into the class and taught what Robbie Burns had actually said, you know. So my thoughts on teachers vary from one direction to another sometimes, I have to be honest. But how would the quality of Scots language education in schools these days be assessed? How would you know who was delivering it, you know, to the best and highest standards? Is there going to be something that people have to get qualified in first in the same way as they would if it was Gaelic?
No, it's currently not something you have to be qualified in, but the option for training is there. Yeah. Like yourself, so many people experience the either ridicule or actual punishment for using Scots, and that highlights how much of a cultural shift we're facing in them promoting a language. And you can imagine for how many teachers who come to me for training who are saying, I wish I'd had this as part of my training that I did years ago. Yeah. Instead, it's a policy reversal, but it's a timely policy reversal. It's been needed for a long time. No child in Scotland should be discriminated against for the language they speak, particularly if it's a language that their parents brought them up speaking. Yeah. And no member of staff in Scottish schools should be discriminated against for being a Scots speaker. It's another string to your linguistic bow. It's more language capital. It's further vocabulary. It chimes with the four capacities of the curriculum for excellence about being an effective contributor, a successful learner, a confident individual, a responsible citizen. So the role of Scots has been needing work like this in the bill for a long time. And I have a huge amount of confidence in the teaching profession that they'll continue to teach the language to a very high standard. We hear from the SQA that the work that gets submitted in Scots, particularly pieces like creative writing for English Higher Folio pieces, that the work in Scots is to a very high standard. It's full of creativity. And that should be of no surprise given the wealth of literature that Scotland has produced in Scots language, Robert Burns included, and so many more modern day writers. So it's important that we take the responsibility to offer training for teachers, offer guidance. This is something Education Scotland we've taken very seriously for the 10 years that I've been there, and I'm aware that I'm just standing on the shoulders of so many other Scots language advocates and intellectuals and activists from years previous and generations previous who wish to see this policy coming into place. And the time is now for Scots for this to happen, and I do believe that the teaching professional will do incredibly well and embrace it, and it's up to us to provide the guidance and support, and we'll do that by the same ways that we've got to this point as part of a community. Education Scotland will work with Scottish universities, we'll work with the Dictionary of the Scots Language, the Scots Language Centre, we'll work with yourselves here, the MSPs, and we'll make sure that we get it right for Scots and we get it right for every child in Scotland.
I was just wondering, one thing I believe it's true, and but I don't know for sure, is the fact that pupils who go along to the Gaelic schools actually have an enhanced learning capacity for other languages, whether they're European or whatever sort of thing. I don't know if anybody knows if that is actually an actual thing or if it's just a bit of, you know, is it true, do you think, Seanie?
Yep. In terms of having an increased capacity?
Well, if you're learning at a Gaelic school, your capacity for learning other languages on top of that grows as well, then, is that?
Yeah, I think the benefits of bilingual education are widely documented, with Gaelic or otherwise, and that has an enormous range of cognitive benefits, not just in terms of language acquisition, but it does provide benefits across learning. Yeah. I think that's fairly well established by research.
Well, that would be beneficial for everybody then, actually, Scots and Gaelic, actually, yeah, going abroad rather than having to try and find a pub where they speak English and things like that sort of thing. Not if you're a child, of course. Can I ask if you believe, I mean, in recognising the importance of this bill, both for Gaelic and Scots, do you think that the provision in the bill should actually be also including Scots medium education, school education, in a much more upfront way, and maybe at some point, once we're more confident about things, we can have a Gaelic language bill and a Scots language bill as well? I mean, I'm happy that it exists as it does, but do you think that could develop in that direction as things progress?
Probably looking at a much longer time there, timeline, but the detail that's, I think, often gets muddied in terms of Scots medium education is Scots is a sister language to English, mm-hmm, and Scots and English are used in parallel so often, whereas in a GME setting, you're not using English, you're using specifically Gaelic.
Aye.
So a Scots medium school would have English used a lot, and so there'd be a very different setup going on. But I believe that there's Scots medium education happening far more than we're aware, particularly in rural settings where there's smaller class numbers, and the teacher will know every bairn here speaks Scots, and if I speak in Scots, every single child understands. Right. So it'll be happening more than you think, and it might be less of a need to have designated spaces. But I think that it's, to go back to the point about learning one language, education, learning another language, you learn so much more, and it's that value of languages is creating so much space for fulfilment of the four capacities of the curriculum for excellence that whether it's Gaelic or Scots, it's of benefit to so much of their educational experience.
Okay. Thank you.
I bring
much.
Jones being keen to come in on of your questions there, Mr. Kidd.
Yes. I was going to come in on the question you asked around quality and assessing quality. So as an inspectorate, we very much welcome this new legislation for Scots, and we appreciate that it has got a resource implication for us, and we are keen to be supporting and evaluating Scots in education as part of our inspection work. So going forward, we will be looking at that. We are also very keen to ensure that we use all our inspection evidence and all that we can report using our ability to see first-hand observations as much as possible for both Scots and Gaelic. We have our embedded processes for Gaelic because we're further on in legislation with Gaelic, so we would also envisage looking at how we can support Scots in appropriate ways.
Thank you very much indeed. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. And can I now bring in Michelle Thompson? Thanks, Michelle.
Good morning, everybody. I just want to touch on an area that we've not really considered thus far, and that is in terms of what the bill might enable in terms of improving access for adult education, further types of education in either Gaelic or Scots. I mean, I suspect Donald and Joan will have a view, but Bruce as well, yourself from a Scots perspective. So do you see anything further enabled by this bill in terms of further adult education or indeed other sorts as well?
Will I start? Yes, I think
yeah,
so.
As well,
yeah,
so.
Absolutely. I think it absolutely will. I think it may be on several different levels. We've spoken about the 3 to 18 pathway that's been recognised, and the importance of continuing language learning into adulthood for those who have started that journey in their possibly in their ELC or at primary one, and that linking to important socioeconomic drivers that each of the Gaelic communities have, or for that matter, Scots. But I think there's also, and I've seen this again within my own local authority, a real thirst and demand for beginning at language learning in adults, particularly, for instance, in parents who have made a choice for Gaelic medium education, wishing to undertake adult learning in language to support their own children and learning alongside them. And there's definitely evidence of increasing demand for adult learning in language, and particularly in my own context within Gaelic, and I hope that the provisions of the bill and possibly around that a benefit of identifying areas of linguistic significance that will allow greater prominence of that for the whole community. And I think that's where there's huge potential for more community partnership, coming back to something we discussed earlier about Gaelic or Scots being active languages in the community and how adult learners, it'll be important for them also to be able to have confidence to speak the language in community settings, in the local shop, at events, where they feel that they're able to learn language and have it supported by the local authority or the learning provider, but also be able to have confidence to use it in their own community. So I very much would agree and hope that the bill does bring growth in adult learning in both these areas, the pathway through from education into post-school destinations, but also for adult learners engaging with language for the first time.
Thank you. And I'll bring you yourself in, Bruce, but overlaying a comment you were making earlier about changing culture in terms of creating that environment where people have permission to speak in effect, their own language. Would you agree that it will enable further adult kind of participation from local authorities, but would it also enhance that kind of legitimisation from your perspective for Scots?
of course, any education policy has to be mindful of the views and the values of the parents, you know. And Education Scotland, Joan and I have colleagues who are CLD officers, community learning development officers for adult learning, and have done partnership work with them many times. Sometimes when you think of that adult learning, you think of a much older age range, perhaps, you know, 50 to 70, but a lot of adult learners are 20 and they perhaps left school. And why is a 20-year-old returning as an adult to do more learning? It's generally because their school experience wasn't very good and they want to enhance and get more qualifications. Now, in a great many cases, that 20-year-old is a Scots speaker. So offering Scots provision and adult learning is equally important as it is for children aged 3 to 18 and at university level. For adult learners, it could be someone like Bill, who wants to reflect on their school experience and the wrongs that they were done when he spoke Scots at school and how he was punished unjustly. So we want to make sure and embrace that that feeling amongst the adult learners that their Scots is something that they can be proud of today, and it's recognised here at the Scottish Parliament, and there's legislation to make being a Scots speaker a protected characteristic.
Thank you. Joan, do you want to come in on either of these points?
Just to say I support what my colleagues have been saying, and we see the benefits of adult learning Gaelic and Scots in an identity in itself, but also as part of that totality of learning and having Gaelic and Scots vibrant and living in the community. So we see the possibilities within the legislation for that.
Anything to add, Seanie?
Other than to say that I agree with what the panel have said, and for Gaelic in particular, and I'm sure this is true of Scots, is that it needs to be normalised in day-to-day life and become part of people's considerations when they're looking at careers. And so in terms of further and higher education, do we have education in place that can allow people to continue from their school education through the medium of Gaelic, and thinking about things like apprenticeships or foundation apprenticeships that are starting in fifth and sixth year, how do we continue that provision into adulthood to keep people engaged with the language? Because I think that's the big question that's going to follow once, you know, if we get to the stage where education is, we're happy with the outcomes there, is how do you maintain that connection with the people who have graduated from Gaelic medium education or Gaelic learners education and continue to use the language in adulthood in their day-to-day lives?
Thank you very much. Okay, that's super. Thank you very much. And that brings our first evidence session of the morning to an end. And I'd like to thank you all for coming along this morning. Thank you for our interesting session. We're now going to have a suspension until 10:45 to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much.
You ready? Right, welcome back, everyone. We're now going to take evidence from our second panel today on the Scottish Languages Bill. And welcome, everyone, and thank you for joining us. I'm going to... It's the echoing through the headsets. I think, hold on 2 seconds. Is it your surface? It seems to have stopped. No. Maybe do you want me to mute your surface? Let's try. No. We'll try again. Not quite. We just suspend for a second. Okay, is that better? It is better. Thank you very much. We've got someone coming down just to double check anyway. So we'll start again. Can I ask by starting our witnesses to introduce themselves and to say which organisations they are representing today. I'm going to go online first, if that's okay. Over to yourself, Lydia. You don't need to touch anything. Someone will unmute you. If you just wait, that's fine. Carry on.
Good morning, Convener, and good morning, Committee. My name is Lydia Roma. I'm a Principal and Chief Executive of UHI North West and Hebrides.
Thank you. Starting on the right. Yes, my right. Yes, sorry.
Good morning. My name is Sylvia Warnecke. I represent the Open University, and I am currently Associate Head of the School of Languages and Applied Linguistics.
Good morning, my name is Inga Burney and I represent the Scottish Council of Deans of Education Languages Group.
Thank you.
Madin Va, Smisha Gillian Roch, Principal Solmo Rostig, Ha Gaelic Acum, Agasa Björlog Alth, Acum Kuchach, She Doric Kikied, Chan and Acum, Agasami Mochtel of Yisho.
Okay, thank you. We're going to move straight to members' questions, and members are going to direct their questions to specific panel members, but should you wish to come in, please catch my eye. We've got a lot going on with the virtual nature of today, or one of the clerks. And Lydia, if you can put an R in the chat if you want to come in, just in case I don't see you waving or catching my eye. Okay, so the first question today, this is going to test us, isn't it, for the first one. We're going to go to Willie Rennie, who is also online, and he will ask the first group of questions. Thank you, Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. This is for Dr. Burney, and it's about teacher recruitment. So I want to understand what the challenges are in recruiting Gaelic teachers and how effective the recent policy change has been to improve that recruitment into ITE courses.
Thank you so much for your question. Can I just clarify which policy you're referring to at the end there? Is that the bursary scheme or any other policy?
It's all policies. And now I'm supposed to ask you questions. So it's any changes that have been implemented. I would quite like to know how they've benefited.
Okay, currently we're facing challenges in terms of recruiting Gaelic and Gaelic medium teachers. This is kind of not, due to the complex nature. Obviously, when you teach a language, you need to be proficient in the language. For the teaching of Gaelic as a subject at secondary level, you are required to be a proficient Gaelic speaker, have a minimum number of credits in the Gaelic language, which is typically delivered through, for example, either a Gaelic medium course, such as provided by our colleagues at Salma Rosteg, or a Celtic studies degree. The numbers for these courses, and I'm kind of I can't speak for Salmo, but Celtic studies degrees are quite small, which obviously impacts again then on the number of people that then want to become Gaelic teachers at secondary level. At Gaelic medium primary provision, we also require a level of proficiency which is not standards for which are not set, although we kind of we require a proficiency of at entry points. We typically recruit undergraduates, primary education students who have gone through the Gaelic medium education system and are proficient speakers of the language. Again, the numbers are quite small and so currently not sufficient to move and meet demand. So we're kind of facing quite significant recruitment because obviously to be able to teach through the language, you need to be proficient in the language. And to meet demand, would possibly need an increase in numbers. There's been quite a few recruitment drives to promote Gaelic teaching as a career path. This has been quite successful. We've also increased opportunities for delivering different subjects, for example, at secondary level through the medium of Gaelic and different pathways. There have been different opportunities to take teachers who are already teaching in English medium and retrain them or support them into working in Gaelic medium, both at primary and secondary. These have been reasonably successful. The numbers are quite small and they continue to be small due to the small number of Gaelic speakers, proficient Gaelic speakers we have.
Would anybody else like to come in?
Is that about Gaelic only, or would you like some input on Scots, which I could provide?
You could do Scots too.
So the first session this morning, really it struck me at what different stages the two languages are in terms of infrastructure that is there to support them. With Scots, it's a very different story from what Inge was telling us. We don't really have a qualification as such for teachers to become teachers of Scots as it stands. Bruce spoke this morning about, you know, working with teacher training colleges to provide input for teachers. But what we're seeing from the teacher course we've been running is that there is a real appetite among the teaching profession for developing qualifications. And as was mentioned last week in the evidence session, we also believe that we need an incremental approach to this because we need to gather data as well about what is really working, what's required to meet particular needs. The way we went about it with our teacher training course was that we decided we offer it to every teaching professional in primary and secondary across the curriculum, and we were bowled over by the amount of people who came and wanted to participate. So we had to date 150 teachers who signed up with very little advertising from our end, and we're keeping this open and we're seeing more and more teachers coming already for the next presentation. And all we're hearing is that the teachers believe it's an important part that enhances the curriculum, an important contribution, and meeting the needs of those Scots speakers that are already in the school. We heard this morning the differences of different dialects and classrooms and areas where other dialects are spoken, but we're already seeing from what teachers are telling us that they're finding approaches that work for themselves as well as the pupils. And at the end of the day, we're always seeing that bringing Scots into education is about empowering the learners and bringing their linguistic repertoire to the classroom. So I think the recruitment is not so much of an issue. It is empowerment and validation that teachers are needing. And that's why we're so much welcoming this bill, because that will provide it. And teachers have given this verbatim in feedback to us that that is what they want.
OK, thanks very much. That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Can we now come to questions from Ross Greer, please? Thank you.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, everybody. You may have caught some of the evidence from Donald McLeod in the previous session, where we began to touch on the position in ELC and particularly some of the workforce issues for early learning and childcare. I think in the first instance, this may be a question for yourself, Inge. What What would the pathway be for somebody who wished to work in ELC in a Gaelic medium setting? What's the qualification pathway at present?
At present, there is an HNC offered through UHI. My colleagues will put me right. But mostly we rely on the current linguistic ability of our early years practitioners to deliver Gaelic medium education effectively. So this kind of relies on them being proficient or confident speakers of the language. So the current pathway is the same as early years provision in English medium. And of course, one of the issues, and I'm sure this was touched on this morning, and I'm sure it's one of the things that kind of comes up, providing children with a language learning experience early on can be a very powerful tool to reach proficiency. Although we do need to recognise that for many of our young children, this is an additional language. So we can't just assume that the teaching of languages, even to 2, 3 and 4 year olds, is the same as acquiring your mother tongue. Mm-hmm. And actually acquires a different pedagogical approach that needs to mesh in with the best practice in early years provision, which is very much play-based in Scotland. So although there's currently not many pathways to providing this, there is some opportunities offered through SOMROS, like I'm sure my Gillian will put me right if that was not the case. So currently the pathway is the same, and currently much of the early years workforce are doing this by their own proficiency in the language and have done the same pathway as they have done for the English medium provision in early years.
And keen to hear from Gillian and Lydia on that as well, if you'd like. But just to check then, so the current state of play is to get the... Is it HND that you said rather than HNC?
HNC.
HNC. And is that currently only available through UHI?
It's Hardy Kindjach, Hardy N, Etrol, Leandrig, OGE. Agus han cwjym y dolth i'r sgilen ffilantach gybi yn lwch gobrach ffilanta a sychanan agus cwjach gybi at egsar arst ira y hwf curriculum.
Thanks very much. And can that course be delivered remotely at present, or is that only delivered as part of an in-person experience?
Ag a lifrygig i'r astar.
Thank you. And looking more widely beyond the initial qualification, we've talked in the previous session about the workforce challenge issues with recruiting, but also retaining teachers in GME. Is that a similar situation for retention of ELC staff in GME settings? Inge?
I have actually personal experience. It continues to be challenging. Early years provision kind of staff recruitment and retention is an issue across the board, and in Gaelic medium settings it's particularly so because of the additional challenges I'm sure this morning was maybe touched upon as well, in terms of language acquisition and supporting young people in reaching sort of proficiency in the language before they start primary school. So there are additional challenges over and above the challenges that English practitioners face. So there are recruitment challenges in terms of and retention challenges here as well, dissimilar to primary and secondary school provision.
Thank you. Lydia, is there anything that you would like to add on this point?
That's you, sorry.
Sorry, the microphone. I think the question is really relevant, and having clear pathways into Gaelic medium workforce and vocational sectors is really important. And UHI Northwestern Hebrides is based in the Gaelic speaking heartlands. And we work closely with our colleagues in Salmarostic and UHI in order to improve access to Gaelic medium vocational pathways, including into early years health and social care, which are key sectors, not just to support early years language acquisition for young people, but also link generations in terms of and communities in terms of living Gaelic Gaelic-speaking communities and support and strengthen those Gaelic-speaking communities, particularly in those areas that have Gaelic as a linguistic significance and part of their predominant identity of culture and heritage.
Ruth McGuire wanting in on a supplementary on that theme, if we keep that going, and I'll come back to you.
Yeah, please do.
Matinva, I just wondered how many were taking up the course by distance learning. I mean, we've heard earlier that having the offering from 3 to 18 is really important. And I know, obviously, communities will have playgroups and parent as pasture and all these things, but how many folk are taking up the early learning qualification by distance learning? And if you had any notion of which parts of the country they were from?
Hanyil Nadav Akamsa, Achafism Gavokuchiganas Lokesh Jok, Ekavil Nadav.
Okay.
Ashu Kayeri.
Okay. Warren Tang.
We can certainly get that provided afterwards if you wish to submit that, Dr. Munro. Thank you. Back to Ross Greer, please.
Thanks, Camina. And if we stick with Dr. Munro for the next question, if that's okay. The 3 to 18 curriculum model and curriculum for excellence, essentially what we've got when we're talking about it in GME settings is we have a curriculum that is designed and produced in English, and then we work backwards to deliver it in GME. What would there be particular advantages to a Gaelic a curriculum model that originates itself in Gaelic, and what do you think the challenges would be to developing that?
Stuhan hurig biastjes kind, stuhan hurig biastjes yolish, hurig fjord in a caravan, root big tanner, and a curriculum is on sarvage, a hoof coulter, is on the Gaelic, and drasta, amihin, a pastjak and beans, amifaikin, shorsa, adjahug, a ham pastjin a fein, anabi ked, marishan plur, a levig, gmatrik. Hanyl Sciaf i'r cwlter a hachemich a lora. Lesion am ismaniach a gyfolgadas yn y mwysion y gwyd y gyfi biastiach ag y maach ag y curriculum ys o'n sa'r fahes.
Okay, if I can add a thank you, Gillian. I think to mirror some of the submissions that were made, I think, this morning and online, currently, you know, part of the, I think the aspect is that we are treating Gaelic medium education as a translation of the English medium curriculum by and large. And I think this brings challenges for young people in particular. And I think these are important to raise, because if they see that the only difference in their education is the language in which it's educated, they cannot say, why are we doing this in Gaelic if we can also do it in English? And I think the cultural aspect, best practice from other educational contexts has shown us that including a cultural element is so important for developing sort of this pluricultural identity, by which I mean sort of children sort of learning about a sense of place and space in Scotland and where Gaelic fits. I would mirror Gillian to say there's some great resources out there, but also some resources that are currently, like reading schemes, I think Gillian touched on, are currently translated from English. One of the challenges might be possibly that we're looking at something that is not equal but equivalent to an English medium curriculum. So there are aspects that are maybe challenging about this, particular maybe, you know, parents would need to be carefully informed about how the English and Gaelic medium curricula sort of align in terms of further opportunities, especially as we move into the secondary provision. I know we're looking at 3 to 18, but it's a concern that parents have over Gaelic medium education. They kind of want to make sure that it's the same quality and quality that English medium education provides. There are options within the current curricular frameworks for supporting this or making changes, and perhaps putting, I know that's possibly part of the discussion this morning, a greater emphasis on Gaelic language learning, acquisition and cultural aspects associated with the Gaelic language. That would kind of strengthen this position within the curriculum.
Thank you very much. That's all from me, convener, unless anybody else on the panel wants to come in on that.
Dr.
Munro. Dr. Munro, come back.
Fyd mi ddech bygan y farach gychwyddiis a mi chomoch jyl yn jyw fi sŵi yn y parlament yn y halaba ysyn y torch ara gan y canain agos gan y cwlltaran a hadwn i brin as na coi asnioch gan Jimmy Gellorn ffadr o ada a sy'n rybu mwchag sen agos a chocwtrymoch gan Jade yn bel sio tron y farlamach sain na yfyrdochys gyfel na party yn ŵlyg Jimmy Gellor y fwrst yn jyw gyfel na party yn ŵlyg i'r ffarty comity har ffarty na Gaelic as y farlamach gyfel sy'n fwlyg y cwrtaig rin y canain fa mi mae wabas a chyg yn trech yn sychau fi clynion biach cwch gan bychor gein stat chwyr i'r anobar a hys yn y gian efo'r fel a crwai e mir a ffiket bleol nawn mae'r eisiau yn blerfa fa ach na Gaelic da fi lys y coig i'r y gol tre agos yn taw mac ein barach gyian efo son slwog na halaba agos Sylwm i na pwynt gynnais yn y tocal mae yw'n curriculum ys yn sa'r fahys a sy'n hen na eisiamplar i'r cho tana sa sy'n i'r tycsyn na sy'n y tort siachet go parent yn sgach clawn ac ys yn taw mewn curriculum ys yn sa'r fahys a ienw ffrigarach ys yn cwlthyr na Gaelic ac ys cwlthyr biorlog awlta.
Okay. Thank you. Can I bring in Liam Kerr with a supplementary on that theme before I come to Pam Duncan Clancy?
It's just a question for Lydia Romer, based on what Dr. Munro's just said. Lydia, in your submission, Lydia, you've said it would be better to have two separate bills, one for Scots and one for Gaelic, because it risks muddying the waters and causing confusion if they're together. Now, you've heard how passionately Dr. Munro's just spoken about the Gaelic side of the bill. So could you develop the point as to what you would like to see happening in terms of splitting the bills and whether that would actually be a good thing for this committee to take on board?
Yes, thank you very much for the question. I think the point that we were trying to make in our submission was that Gaelic is in a very fragile state, and perhaps in a despite all the efforts and despite the Gaelic Language Act, and this bill is seeking to strengthen the Gaelic Language Act, but it also brings in new provisions for Scots. And whilst those provisions for Scots are important for their own reasons, there is further effort required to strengthen Gaelic. And I wholeheartedly support the emotion and position of Gillian Munro and the sentiment that she's just expressed. Gaelic is a vital part of identity and cultural life and history in Scotland, and does require more to be done than is perhaps, despite all the efforts of the previous legislative efforts, and has been the case. We have, despite all the efforts, not really significantly increased the numbers of Gaelic speakers in Scotland. So any bill needs to really, and the bill before us should demonstrate not just the commitment to what happens in school, but what actually needs to be done in order to support those communities where Gaelic is spoken actively, but where without further intervention and support and very targeted support, perhaps within a generation, the current kind of generation that does speak Gaelic as a native language may not be with us anymore. So there's an intrinsic link between what happens in school in order to ensure Gaelic language education, but also to move that into a much bigger portfolio of Gaelic medium education and to support the fluency and proficiency of Gaelic, not just as a language, but as an economic and social asset. So that means, alongside all the efforts that are done in statutory education, to also support the parents of children, whether they are Gaelic learners themselves or whether they are latent speakers of Gaelic. So you talked about the need for a distinctive Gaelic literacy framework that is not just a translation of an English language approach. That is not just the case for a school setting, but that is also the case in terms of recognising literacy needs of adult learners who quite often may have not been able to exercise Gaelic whilst they were in school or post-school, and who come from an oral tradition but would value access to Gaelic medium adult literacy. There is also a need to recognise the role of post-school provision in making pathways into vocational areas available in Gaelic medium. And at the moment, the really beyond Gaelic medium teacher training and perhaps one or two areas, as has already been described, there isn't really a concerted effort in Scotland on making post-school Gaelic medium pathways available to a wider audience. So there are lots of opportunities, there are lots of resources, but it's actually how these resources are harnessed in order to really seriously drive the increase in proficient Gaelic speakers across all areas of public life that will create the environment in which Gaelic medium education and Gaelic language acquisition in schools then becomes much more natural going forward. And I would welcome in the bill some recognition of what success would look like following the provisions of this bill, together with a framework of measurements, outcomes and impacts that actually signify the distance that should be travelled through the provisions of the bill.
Thank you. Can I now move to questions from Pam Duncan-Clancy, please?
Thank you, Convener. Thank you and good morning to everyone for joining us. Sorry for the interruption earlier with the technology, and I appreciate your patience on that. I want to ask a bit about the number of learners who are achieving SQA qualifications. So this morning we heard from CLAS that, and their submission was that a number of pupils leaving Gaelic medium education with no qualifications in the language is of serious concern. And they noted that it was worth considering the numbers of pupils involved and whether an overall increase in 230 SQA awards over 36 years is satisfactory progress. So can I ask the panel firstly, do they think that is satisfactory to do what we've all just heard is important in terms of education?
Any progress is progress, so to take your question, but I would agree that maybe it is not satisfactory in terms of the long-term outcomes we would like to see for Gaelic. I kind of mirror the concerns raised this morning. We have a greater number of young people enrolled in Gaelic medium education and are doing Gaelic qualifications. And this does not mean that these young people don't have any proficiency in Gaelic. They just don't have the bit of paper to prove they don't have the proficiency in Gaelic, and we kind of measure things by bits of paper, so qualifications. And I think it's something, you know, we could look at. We also kind of, obviously, we speak about Gaelic learners, which is a different strand. And, you know, there maybe will be questions coming about that later. But in terms of what the overall outcomes we would like to see for Gaelic, no, this progress is maybe not satisfactory in terms of sustaining Gaelic for the future.
Thank you. Dr. Munro.
Morning, Tang. Hami gantach agle inga. Ach anila gyor, anil na hadavan, ars gyor. Ha krap starig mourain, agus gmiorstanach. Anil datas avil agani the show. Ha dolgar kujachag. Hanil and cor ig parentin fallam trivian na Gaelic. Ansavil show, agus shinarut avig a fosglig na dorsan. Go Fuasglian imedach dwliadus. Agus ha mígeach nach hiel ach un dunne as a hied an a bunskol a genu fallam trivienna Gaelic. So gun a bitarch corum go parentan corichen fallam trivienna Gaelic, hanilchen dolagaichen fas. So shinne hied root a yemischen gian of nam a viachin.
Thank you. Do others have, or indeed Dr. Munro, do you want to build on what they think is preventing the greater uptake in, of the range of SQA qualifications in this area?
It's a complicated picture, part to do with like low numbers, low uptake, part to do with the perception, the documented perception that to do a qualification, for example, geography through the medium of Gaelic is more complicated than doing it through the medium of English. And because these qualifications matter to young people's career progression, they often opt to do them through the medium of English, even where they are available. In terms of doing the Gaelic language, so for example, Gaelic learners education, it's back to earlier provisions. So if young people are not provided with the opportunities to learn the language in primary school, then it's much harder to stimulate the uptake at secondary school. Languages all around are facing challenges, and Gaelic is not alone in facing these challenges. But then the numbers get smaller the higher up the qualifications you get, and that kind of also is impacted in schools by, you know, do we offer a language that is, doesn't have a high uptake with our school pupils? So it's kind of a very complicated picture that adds to it. I kind of want to pick up something that Dr. Munro said earlier about making Gaelic medium education more readily available. It's maybe a point that this committee will come back to later. Having, you know, the complication of having to demand Gaelic medium education and having quite a complicated process to ask for Gaelic medium education is a significant barrier for parents in enrolling their children in Gaelic medium education. It requires a significant effort on the part of parents to ask for Gaelic medium education where this is currently not available. And this kind of stops parents enrolling their children, you know, that there aren't the opportunities. So it's maybe something the panel will come back to later.
Thank you. Do others want to comment on the points raised about the what we need to do to increase more uptake of SQA qualifications? Or yeah, Lydia, thank you.
Is this
Sylvia? I was getting. I'm getting. It's very confusing when I've got an earphone in here when you're talking to me. Who are we going to? Sylvia, please. Yeah. Thank you.
Maybe to add what's happening in the Scots picture here, it's again a different situation. We do have SQA awards, and we're seeing real growth in numbers, especially in schools where teachers begin to implement Scots. They're really building on this and then see that this is a brilliant way to certify pupils' linguistic repertoire, the skills they bring to the education anyway. And teachers are asking for this. And on our course, teachers repeatedly now say, we do want a higher in Scots. We do want something that allows us to plan from early years through to, you know, 3 to 18 with a qualification to finish off. And then, as everybody said this morning, to have a pathway into higher education as well with the language. And I think that's an important message, because we've already spoken with the SQA, for example, to think about what such a higher could look like. Of course, in the context of educational reform, we need to plan carefully and gather more evidence. But I think that would be an excellent way to prepare also a qualification for teachers. And we've already looked at coming up with a certificate for continuing education for in-service teachers, who can then add Scots to their portfolio and then deliver this higher in schools. So that would be a kind of easy access way to then think longer term about initial teacher education and bringing Scots into that. So there's already a lot of will and desire in the community to move into that direction.
And
can I bring in Lydia first, please, because she had indicated that she wanted to contribute. Thanks. Lydia, you shouldn't have to touch anything. It should. That's fine. OK.
Thank you very much. I think eScol is actually should be highlighted here to the committee as a way to perhaps increase access to Gaelic, both for learners as well as for Gaelic medium speakers, as a way to increase numbers in SQA. So as a college, we are a partner with eScol, and we provide Gaelic at levels 5, 6 and 7 to eScol, and through eScol to a national audience. So the numbers are increasing. So we had 88 enrolments in 22-23. This year we have 145 enrolments. But that is a mix of school pupils, and it's also, as eScol is open to adults, it's also adults beyond school. And the dominant trend is for adults beyond school to take up those qualifications. And eScol has a high success rate for an online delivered course at in our case, about 66% of people achieving a qualification, a formal qualification at those levels. But I think it's fair to say the higher the qualification level, the smaller the numbers. And I think it's important to recognise that certification for those who seek Gaelic proficiency is not always desired along the way. So for there's different kind of issues, perhaps for school pupils in senior phase, where they are already coming from a Gaelic speaking background. Perhaps they don't see the relevance of taking up an SQA qualification, but are looking to prioritise in terms of their career choices, other National 5 hires and advanced hires. But for those who are seeking to learn Gaelic, is Gaelic competing potentially with another foreign language? And where does Gaelic take them beyond achieving the qualification, both within the senior phase pathway, but also beyond school? And I think this is where the issues about promoting Gaelic as an economic asset that is relevant to a workforce where there are jobs linked to Gaelic really forms an important part of incentivising young people to take up Gaelic opportunities whilst in school.
Dr. Burney, you're looking to come in again.
I've got 2 points to make, partly to do with Gaelic and one related to Scots. So in terms of Gaelic provision, it's also obviously linked to having the available teachers either to deliver Gaelic as a language or Gaelic as a subject, or deliver subjects through the medium of Gaelic. And there's currently a national shortage, I think I can say, of teachers that can deliver different qualification levels through the medium of Gaelic, with very few secondary schools being able to provide the full curriculum through the medium of Gaelic due to lack of teachers able to do so. I want to pick up something that Sylvia mentioned about Scots. Currently, one of the barriers for primary schools introducing the Scots language as part of the 1+2 languages policy is that the L2, so the second language that's introduced from early primary school, is expected to be delivered up to and including qualification level. And of course, without a qualification in Scots being available, the option for schools is often to deliver this as the L3, so the third language, which can also be delivered as an interdisciplinary learning project. So actually hearing the news that a qualification will be available for Scots will actually open up opportunities for the inclusion of Scots as an L2 across Scottish primary schools.
OK, thank you. Briefly, if you don't mind, I've got my eye on the clock again as convener, Sylvia, so if you, and then Pam's got another question as well. Thanks.
Talking about aspirations in that scenario, I think something that's coming through very strongly to us as well is to provide a range of flexible opportunities to access learning Scots language and about the language. That ranges from across the curriculum to you know, delivering this for learners who are non-native speakers who are coming to Scotland, like us, and you know, for adult education, but also in school. And we are seeing the teachers' pedagogies they're developing on our teacher training course, that they're building a lot on pedagogies from languages, teaching languages. And this can be very powerful to bring in Scots as a language subject as well. So I think there are different places in the curriculum for the language as well. Also, as you said, Inga, it needs to be related to culture as well.
Thank you, Pam. Back
thank
to yourself.
You. Thank you. And all of what you've just described, some of it is already being done, I think, and like Inga, I also welcome some of the changes that you've spoke about. What does this bill need to... Is there anything in the bill that needs to change in order to deliver what you think it needs to deliver for education, Gaelic medium education?
Okay. I think when we speak about clear, you know, achievements and targets, I think we need to be very clear about the outcomes for Gaelic medium education, as particularly linguistic outcomes. Mm-hmm. And it's very difficult to maybe describe this in a bill, and a bill might have to be secondary legislation or policy. But it's important that we clarify what Gaelic medium education is for, what it hopes to achieve, the proficiency levels of our young people, what we hope they can do with the language when they leave school. And I want to kind of say, you know, applaud the amazing work that our workforce, teaching workforce, is doing in supporting language acquisition across Scotland, both for Gaelic learners education and in Gaelic medium education. And I think we can strengthen it, the bill, by making clear provision around linguistic outcomes. What do we expect, and a clear pathway for our young learners to follow in terms of progression and outcomes?
Dr. Munro.
Moran Tang. Bimi Gamad Gaddich, a Miss Munya Huggable Fame, Air Cor Lugal, Air Falum Gaelic, Shawvi Igparantin, Agus Clown. Agus Colliery Shin, Gavel Fame, Air Immersh Vore, Avi Trenig Hitcherin, Agus Avi Genu Shin, Colliery Gudamich Ked, Air Duich Nambaskach, Mara Rainatsen, Chiffer Homor, and Unia Hoggadich, Agus Vakielachig, Avi Peg Teacherin, in Lan Tourestel, Agus Big Unia Gilorachka, Vi Fas Filanta Sahanan, Agus Gumpachug, Govi Chekas Trovian Baskish, Kersonach Jinshin Hin, Rutikin Koloch Rishin, Shin Kesh Mayoin Resources Hamikinach, Ach Magucha Nachilan Bilsho, Jelig Bulach Rishin, Ach Gutamich Vigama Radikach, Agus Vi Molog, Doi Ur, a teacher in Rusig, Agus teacher in Renig, teacher in Haikachug. A famic teacher in Kuchach, Hanning and Tresrut, Toravarach, Taik, Hybrin, Re, Eid, Ho, Unranach, Sahai, V. Gopar in a class, a Chekas Trovian Gaelic, Nachil Nagurda Sanaun, Agus Nachil and Taikan, Sanarshanyach, Agus Nachil Nagurda Sanagat Gaharach, Maha Pashjanagat as a class, Lefemalach and Avarach. Kujak mau chekas gonna follow to be in the Gaelic view trick chekas clown egg jiffer ocean in the anakam heen high in a class let three jiffer eden slashen machin heen naguliatus is famer ked kimmer humishin taik the teacher in a ha as nasuya hen sho hanila ko unigaram gvalmoran mishnach a howl hanasasa vi chekas to be in the bureau. Agus mae sy'n ychydig ar yw'r gyrru Gaelic agus Biorlo Gaelta a fi bio ffeimus yn rwy'n really large ar y ian a fe gynnydd y sio agus fi ffagal stoch y cysyn yn ymwys ag dwnila.
Thank you. Lydia, are you looking to come in, and then I'll bring in yourself, Sylvia?
I would certainly echo what Dylan has just highlighted as key issues for the bill. I'd just like to emphasise the issue on initiatives to teacher training. And within UHI, we are looking to actively, together with Solmar Ostick and our colleagues in UHI, to create new part-time pathways for teacher training, particularly postgraduate teacher training. This shouldn't just be for Gaelic teaching, but it should, as Gillian has said, also kind of extend to support teachers in other disciplines to move into Gaelic medium education and to assist them through through targeted funding initiatives and sabbaticals to move their subject area into Gaelic medium education. And I think it would be really advantageous if Scotland looked to other countries, including other nations within the UK, like Wales in particular, where as part of the Welsh Language Act, their initiatives have been very successful in providing funded kind of opportunities for teachers to move into Welsh medium teaching. So I would echo that we need to make it as easy as possible and as normal as possible as part of this bill, not just to recognise Gaelic as an official language in Scotland, but that we use it throughout and reinforce kind of what happens for parents and children in school and in the wider community and the workplace.
Thank you, Lydia. I would maybe Sylvia can come back on this as well. I mean, with the exception of the right to the Gaelic education, many of those things that you've both outlined don't really require legislation.
I think a clear statement of aspiration is important, and picking up on what Lydia said there, looking at the workplace, looking at the wider community, there are so many barriers to social cohesion because of the language. And, for example, the Open University is currently working with the NHS Education Academy Scotland, and because they want to create dedicated teaching materials for overseas staff coming to work here. And they have already identified staff coming here with very good English still struggle a lot in the workplace, in the staff community, but also if they go out, carers going out into the community, because of a lack of Scots skills and an understanding of related culture. So they wanted us to produce curriculum to deliver that, to really help. And we see that in many other workplaces as well. In our submission, we mentioned a PhD study currently undertaken at the OU, the first one looking into new speakers of Scots, so adults learning Scots. And there's a lot of evidence in there that new speakers decide to learn the language because they feel there is a barrier to their, you know, inclusion in the workplace. So that's another aspect we should look more widely at beyond the school education.
Thank you. Can I now move to Bill Kidd? I know a lot of you might find there's a bit of overlap in the questions here, but I'll let you pick up where you can, Bill Kidd. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Pardon me. Yes, there is an overlap then between the Gaelic school education and Scots school education. However, can I just ask, how are teachers supported in ITE to promote Scots usage in the classroom, please?
Bruce Jensen talking this morning. Yep. As it stands, it's been very much him working with the different ITE institutions in Scotland. There is no substantive curriculum at the moment, so teachers can look at this and get an introductory session into Scots. But that would be another important area to look at. And evidence from our course, again, shows a lot of probationers came to us, signed up to the course because they were passionate about bringing Scots into the classroom. Unfortunately, we had to turn the probationers away for a year until they finished their probation according to GTCS rules, but that was very encouraging to see that lots of young people see there's a huge value in bringing the language. So at the moment there is no substantive provision, but we'd be very keen that that would eventually be the aspiration to train teachers at this stage in the language.
I think Inga's got something.
Yeah, sorry, just to get in there. It's languages, Scottish, including Scotland's languages, tend to be taught as part of the literacy and languages strand. So in ITE provision, when we look at the different curricula areas, Scots and Gaelic will be typically bundled together with other languages as part of the 1+2 policy. There might be specific aspects where we look in literacy, where we look at these languages, but it kind of tends to be bundled as part of the 1+2 provisions in ITE teaching programmes, with the exception of Gaelic medium provision, where obviously the focus is very much on Gaelic language and pedagogies associated with that.
Thank you. Can I just ask, obviously parents will be looking at the best provision of education for their children as they go forward, and they might even, unlike the children frequently, they might be looking forward to exams. So I was just wondering about, qualification side of things and how that is being developed, because as you're saying, to actually get the numbers in the first place of the teachers, and then you've got to get the school time and all that sort of stuff, and then you've got to have exams take place. Is that all working cohesively just now, or is there a problem?
Very interesting outcomes. Sometimes teachers report when they ask their children in the classroom to talk about, some say something in Scots, they say they don't know that language while speaking Scots. Aye. So this, coming back to what Liam Kerr talked about this morning, what makes Scots a language and the awareness of it being a language, that also applies to parents. But we're seeing again, when teachers are beginning to teach Scots in the classroom, parents can relate, because this is something, they had very different experiences, like you mentioned with, and they often then say this is such a positive thing to see. You have your identity and you can bring that to the classroom and make it count. So there's more and more kind of positive attitudes developing among parents as well. We need visionary management in schools as well to buy into this. And again, coming back to the point, that's why it's so important to have that bill as validation and clear guidance and standards as well, so that it will be a proper subject, and I think that will then really lead to higher numbers.
So there's developments of self-confidence as well then, actually, aye. And in fact that can run right across families and indeed communities, should that opportunity present itself or be presented to them.
We've got evidence again that parents want to come into schools and bring, and also intergenerational learning was talked about this morning. That applies to Scots as well. We have evidence of other members of staff who have toned down their Scots when in school because they felt it wasn't appropriate, who then have offered teachers on our course to develop materials for their classrooms. So there is a lot we can build on and make count, so we don't have to start from scratch.
Sure. And in terms of that, then, there are challenges in ensuring that teachers in different areas across Scotland have the resources and the skills to support education in different dialect areas and such, like you've got Lowlands and Doric and etc. So what you're looking at is the opportunity for people to actually use their natural, or not natural, but their acquired language in a way which is to best advantage for the children who are being taught then, sort of thing. And on that basis then, are there challenges for teachers to learn? Because they can't necessarily learn from the person 100 miles down the road, sort of thing,
Only this morning on the train, I read some statements teachers shared with us as part of their assessment, reflections on their practice. And one teacher reported that she is a Glaswegian Scots speaker, now working in Aberdeenshire, teaching a class in primary and thinking, that she should adopt the Doric to make it authentic for the pupils. And then she reflected on that. We had discussions in the forum and it transpired that that wasn't actually necessary. And I think a part of good language education is comparison of different dialects, different language use. And we can add through this, you know, having the teacher speak a different dialect, but allow the pupils to be empowered and bring their dialect into the classroom. Allows deeper understanding of languages, any language, like Scots as well. The materials is an issue, but we are already seeing teachers, as Bruce said, sharing a lot of materials. And, you know, we can take that away as one task for other institutions and partners to look at this, you know, and develop more materials in this area. Sometimes it's also a matter of not knowing what's out there. So building better signposting for teachers to, you know, a databases, but that can easily be achieved. So it is a challenge, but again, it's a lot about awareness and confidence.
Well, as I was saying, and I believe you were here, in the first panel, the advantage of learning or developing language in school is that it frequently actually encourages an interest in the learning of language, and that therefore people might, or children, might actually then go on to be interested in learning Italian or German or whatever sort of thing, you know, as well. And that, and maybe Gaelic also, if they haven't had that opportunity before. So you think that is a genuine sort of, it's an acquired skill which really needs to be encouraged anyway, yeah.
Totally agree, and I think it helps people overcome this stereotype of you have to be clever to learn languages. Many people don't appreciate that they're bilingual when speaking Scots and English. And in the public course we produced, we got a lot of feedback from, you know, members of the Scottish public who had studied it, who began to understand what it means to be bilingual and what an asset that actually is for them. And as we know, you know, uptake of languages is really challenged at the moment in Scotland. And using the route through Scots, a language that has a low threshold because people have skills in the languages already, will then encourage them to see languages are actually not that difficult.
Thank you very much.
I'm looking just quickly. Are you... I was going to call you Dr. Kerr. Mr. Yeah, do you have anything you want to pick up on this?
Yes.
Yes, please. And perhaps we can come to you, Dr. Munro, as well, to answer. Yeah.
It's specifically on that line of question. I'll stick with Dr. Fornica, if I may. The submission that you've put in talks about the Scottish language strategy needing a detailed description of what Scots is and what dialects are spoken and where. Do you have any indication of where that, if that is happening, or would it be better to put that on the face of the bill such that there's clarity about what is being taught and what resources might be being needed?
That's a very good question as well, and I think foregrounding it as much as possible is useful because there is still such a lack of awareness of Scots being conceptualised as a language in its own right with a range of dialects across the country. So again, coming back to what we're hearing from the community and also from the practitioners and schools, that would give them the needed validation to say this is why we're teaching it as a subject and build confidence. So yes, and lots of work is happening in that space already, so we could draw on a lot what's out there. But foregrounding this is an important one for the community as well, to say you're speaking a proper language and it's not bad English or slang.
And on that point, I'm interested in your anecdote about the teacher on the train from this morning. You talked earlier about the course that the OU is running. And you have 150... people enrolled on that, 120 just now and 30 already signed up for the future.
We'll start, yeah.
Given the anecdote you introduced to us, what Scots is being taught on that course? How is it standardised or is it bespoke to each individual learner, each individual teacher, for their area?
That's a very good question. So we are not, the course itself is not teaching the teachers Scots as such. We have the public course where we are teaching about the language of Scots, where it is used, how it is used, and some key features of the language. The commonalities Dr. Dempster talked about in terms of vocabulary, pronunciation, and grammar. To just raise an awareness of an understanding what makes it a language in its own right. We are teaching the teachers strategies to allow the pupils to bring their Scots skills to the classroom. So this is the very first step, to acknowledge Scots as a part of pupils' linguistic repertoire that they can make count in their education. And then taking it further from that point, we should really think about teaching Scots as a subject, as a language to people who are new to it, who've come to Scotland. We hear a lot of primary pupils, for example, teachers are reporting, pupils who are refugees, for example, say, I want to learn Scottish, they call it, to speak to my friends and their families. So there an incremental development towards how we teach other languages. We know Scots doesn't have a standard, and that was discussed in the previous evidence session last week. There is the decision to be made, what kind of standard do we want? I think the key is a written standard. A lot of work has already been done to develop such a thing that is agreed with the community of speakers, but we should also, as Bruce said, celebrate the way it is spoken in different areas. And looking at other countries where I grew up, you could speak your local dialect in the classroom, but you had a common written standard for the language, and that was normal practice.
Forgive me, I guess I'd misunderstood earlier. I'd thought that we were training teachers to teach the Scots language, but that's not what the OU's doing, is it? But the course that you are doing, so confirm that when I throw you the question, if you would. But the course that you are doing, the Scottish Government's paying for that. How long is that funding guaranteed for, and or for how many students to put through that course?
So we were blown away by the numbers, and we asked then the Scottish Government for help to just embed this. So we agreed this for one cohort, mm-hmm. and then wanted to look at how things evolve. Maybe I was wrong to say we're not teaching Scots at all. We do. And we offer different things for different needs. So we have teachers on the course who are fluent, who have already taught Scots, but want this validation that they're doing the right thing. Then we have people who are non-Scots speakers, and they want to learn how to teach this. Many are people who have come to Scotland, and they want to make this part of their work. So we give them opportunities and resources to learn the language if they need it. But we're covering a lot of ground with the course. As I said, it addresses a lot of practitioners from diverse backgrounds and with diverse needs.
I do understand, and forgive me pressing on this, but because you talked there about people wanting to learn Scots and to teach Scots. My initial question was around, you talked about the teacher on the train, mm-hmm. who had learned, if you like, Glaswegian Scots, but was now presumably teaching and responding to Doric, which the teacher reported would be rather different. Mm-hmm. So how does one structure, whether it be the OU or any other provider, how do you structure a course in Scots when what Scots means in one part of Scotland is completely different, or arguably completely different, from what it means in a different part?
I think that builds on what Bruce said this morning as well. You have to embrace the Scots that the learners bring, or the pupils bring to the classroom. And then if the teacher speaks a different dialect, to raise awareness of differences, but also show commonalities within the use of the language in different areas of Scotland. We are not at a stage yet where we can say a text has to be written in a certain way, and there is a standard which the teachers then mark. You know, it is not like in English you can say you've written this word wrong. Mm-hmm. That doesn't exist in Scots at the moment. So we're dealing with a non-standard language. And we talked about the aspiration of bringing in a written standard. Gaelic has that as well, and it was one that was developed with the community. So, you know, we're at different stages in what we teach and how we can teach it because of the situation the language is in. And our main aspiration was to raise awareness, bring it to pupils' education and give them opportunities to use the language in speaking and writing, the language they speak in the home.
Very grateful. Convener.
Thank you. Can we now move to questions from Ben McPherson? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. So I'm looking to ask some questions on the areas of further and higher education. So, first of all, what is the scale of the current provision of Gaelic medium higher education in Scotland, building on what you've already said in previous answers? And what would be the benefits of a Gaelic university in terms of delivery of that? How successful has the Gaelic Plans approach been in supporting Gaelic in college and universities? And should the bill have greater focus on the college and university sector? So a number of questions, but all in the same space. So, you know, answer as you think maybe helpful. Don't know who wants to go first.
Hanilach sol mwrach yn yw ffodd o'n bwgi yn yn ar yn ywch gydwyr trofi yn y galeg sy'n yn yw'n cor yma hagat yn yn alaba as yn ddwyl. Ha cwjach profesion ac yn yna colos ddech astel y fyr ach North West Hebrides ha cwrs i cyn y rwy y sy'n cwjach yna colos ddech hanyl yn yw'n fwgog awn tyfa mwy y chlas ach ha cwrs i cyn y rwy yn sy'n cwjach gas na holhau yn mwra yna dynegyn agos glas ycho agos tro ffol am hitcherin egstodd chwy ha ffol am galic rhi ein yn sy'n cwjach.
Thank you.
Fyd mi len yn y pwyn gynnil yn y cestion nil am y hwc rysiw ach stoch gyfol cach.
To raise the issue about the Gaelic language plans, I think Gaelic language plans have been very important to emphasise the importance of Gaelic in higher and further education provisions and to ensure that that kind of stays embedded within part of their courses. We spoke earlier about teacher recruitment and retention. Part of the recruitment starts before they get to initial teacher education programmes with proficiency, which starts, you know, in schools and then goes on to universities. So making sure that universities are, you know, have a plan for Gaelic is very important, considering the current climate around funding, around languages. We saw at Aberdeen some of the challenges there at keeping the languages department going, and that's kind of an important role. For example, at the University of Strathclyde, where I'm based, it has raised the profile of Gaelic within the wider university and has allowed students to come forward expressing an interest in Gaelic. It's maybe not increased the number of speakers directly, but it has raised the profile of Gaelic within the wider, further and higher education environment.
You can carry on if you wish on some of the other points, if you want to respond to those.
Thank you very much, Gamalushka. Cwmwm i ar amas y Gaelic. A hwf, na bwa noch gan y hygyg le olhau y fi gygwbr trofiau'n y Gaelic. Has yn clachtur i fi smaniach ag yr olhau yn mar yn ydyn ffôl am eglwch mŵr. Ach, hwn choiosnioch Gaelic, chobig, Smashen Kersona Via Mitches on Slacht and Tosh, Nash and Ta, is on Innit and Bjorla, Achlachig, is on Innit Gaelic. Ha Shinigiri can be a Komasach, a Kumfudu, a Vibrin Gaelic, Gaklachig, and an Imadach, Farsh Yedaveha, Vo Og Gushen, Agus Gumfayu Falum, Vo Og Gushen Kuchak, Slashen Drasta, Ha Falum Gaelic Ri Ein, and Chifer Kruhen, Kuchma, Kuch Nachal Makayor, Vo Ire Nyoni, Suas Go Keher Fichet, Achim Pis Ha Yi, She Enet Ha Gober Gatur Trovien Gaelic Le Inneva. All high. Agus virega speech, virega orn vi smanyachag orn heen le speech. Nurabashu feinach na betrea ma yoin bachor and dachanan vi asanun villa, haninse gum bachor. Hashin ag imedach koromaun vi gusachag vo kache heela, agus vi nyastachag kache heela. Which Lydia Nabatre, Gavaligalicness, Stocha Picanus, Kukalicha, Naha, Evior Lagalta, Hanyalism of Oshin Feed, or Isanandahanan, Hakin, Fain Speech, Igbaun, Nitriplachin, Ulig, Agus, Hamihin, Full Englishin, Shebior Lagalta, Hid Hananakam, Ach, Astrui Fichit Bliona, Goparison, Nagalic, Mar Activist, Huer Mimihin, Train and an Operain, Feichkin Kuchikin Lajesha, Koyt Gamas Bajal, Vakam Ribior Lagalta, Vreen Ri Brar Maher, Agus Chaimi gan yn trawnsa, edar yn da charaj, gwrs na clynia gen mi, agos had y hwg mi chodoen sa ha cyn ffein spes, nŵr yn ach ilw ffein yn canan, nŵr yn cwltr agat, a na jyffer ffys yn dy fehe ffwbolach, a na ffôl am mar eisiau blyr. Sla sy'n ha ymadach rwt awn bwyr yn gein i fi gywsachag, fo cach y chila, agos cwtioch chanin Grecaul a hawn, nach oes yn y brin i'r canan ila, chai brin i'r British Sign Language, reg, na gyrdoch o gybachor sy'n y fi awn, ac gyda mewn sy'n fi cwdioch y ceder yn y coers nach yn siniach agos isianach agos a hwyla dwych ila a hach yn y sio. A hwf, Dwi'n mynd i ffala frwt beig bod fi brin ar olhau galeg. Ach, stoch gyfo sy'n gyor yn dras dy hwf olhau galeg. Ach, fan mi ddech, sy'n un fwy'n gaelo i anaf. Anaf i geistrach cyn jw, a sy'n y clynion mŵr yn mae yw'n chocwtrymach sa ha dŵl chaenjyn i anna biorlo gaelta. Agus, anna syl na galeg, a mi smynioch a gyfo sy'n y tycsyn, gyfo dŵl chaenjyn Arlen agus ho injiniach agus ho cwdrymach a hwf fe'n spes ach ag jyr y gwa han unio rwyorn han unio rwyamach agus ffemysyn yn cwdrym y chwyd i'r label as yn arsyniach i'r y galeg agus gwna fi gael drag gyfal teacher fo glasach o y tsegas na galeg an y lywys no teacher fo lywys y tsegas na galeg as yn ylan sgianach han ylwnian fi jesbyt Sin, sy'n rwyt ys cwdrymichia gwn bi yn canan gahegysg, agos gwn tyg clawn agos teacher yn gyfala cwdrymach y fi tyg sy'n dŵl chai'n janila, fi torch spes go dŵl chai'n janila, ach ag jyr y gawa sy'n canan agos yn cwltar ys cwdrymich.
Thank you, Dr. Munro. Lydia, you'd like to come in on this?
Yes, thank you very much, convener. In terms of the scale of Southern higher education, Gaelic medium education in Scotland, I'm with Gillian. The fully immersive environment is in Salmorostic, but obviously UHI as a university of the Highlands and Islands covering those Gaelic speaking communities has an important role to play. And my college is situated in those communities in the Outer Hebrides and in Highland. So we have, in terms of Gaelic language learning, about 300 learners, and part of that is further and higher education, predominantly further education uptake. We have, together with Salmorostic, an ITE course in Gaelic and education, and we also have primary and secondary postgraduate diploma in education. So as a college, we have a share of those Gaelic medium education courses. As a college and the newest college in Scotland through merger just last August, we have taken the opportunity to refresh, to create a Gaelic strategy for the college, which very much kind of builds on four areas, recognising the importance of Gaelic in the community, the importance for Gaelic for curriculum and research, the economy and for people. And we are in the process of developing kind of a bespoke plan on how to increase our Gaelic medium provision in a range of areas. First of all, supporting the proficiency of Gaelic language learning, but linking that intrinsically to our courses in the creative cultures and in heritage. And we build on a joint venture that we have with Ciolas Uist in South Uist, where we're taking a very concerted effort in order to build a curriculum and research culture around Scottish Government funded centre, Croxolier, that actively promotes the Uist Gaelic and culture and heritage in that area. We're working with partners in order, such as Bord na Gaelic and other partners in Highlands and Islands Enterprise in order to support the Gaelic economy. And we're looking at further education levels to develop a Gaelic medium provision, access provision in early years, health and social care in particular. But in addition, we're looking to develop Gaelic medium content that we can build across our vocational curriculum in business, in tourism, and in hospitality, but also areas where there is significant investment in our Gaelic-speaking economies through construction and renewable energy in order to equip that future workforce also with the ability to interact with Gaelic first speaking communities in those areas. I think it's important that the bill recognises, and we made that point in our submission, the role of further education providers beyond the statutory role that's assigned to local authorities for further education beyond school education. And I think there is scope to recognise further the role of universities, not just those universities that are involved in teacher training, and they perhaps all should be assigned, those teacher training providers, a mandatory role to provide Gaelic medium pathways for teacher training, but for all universities to look at opportunities within their curriculum to recognise Gaelic learning opportunities within their various kind of degree pathways. So I think it's a very good set of questions, but I think the role of further and higher education needs to be strengthened perhaps in the bill. I think there, as I said earlier, I think the interaction between providing a strengthened role of Gaelic to the community and then in turn supporting the activities of young people through school in Gaelic acquisition is really important and should be recognised, I think, more formally in the bill.
Okay. Can I? I'm the nasty convener here, and I've got my eye on the clock. Okay, we've still got a number of questions to ask, so can I ask for your responses to this to be succinct, if that's okay?
Response, and I think although Sol Morostig has a very unique position in being able to deliver immersion, further and higher education through the medium of Gaelic, I think it's important that we also maintain the various options out there, various pathways for engaging with Gaelic through the various universities, you know, maybe expanding beyond the current provision, but creating opportunities across Scotland's university network for the learning and teaching of Gaelic.
Thank you. Dr. Munro.
Ik zeg ha hula parsh in the system fallum and a soul na Gaelic agus be an unruit an a bjorlog alta kujach ulig kailtje agus gunn hadavan a vichin tron a bun sculptin tron a hard sculptin Havi Gidorak and Asna Egira Colishin or Olhai Agus Slashin, She Crack Nakuja, Give of Fame, Irlesahug, Egira Bunskol, Fall on Tribune Gaelic, Avina, Hor, Eg Parentin, Sinurshin, Heeshin, Fas, Agus Gintishin. Stochan a Jake Blionilla, Le Ruta Navarra, Kasunagin Gianna Besson FE, Agus HE.
Thank you, Dr. Munro. Sylvia.
Just really like to echo what you all said. I think it's calling it the Scottish Languages Bill raises the awareness of the regional or Indigenous languages of Scotland. And you know, we have so many commonalities and the challenges we face that can only give us strength to move forward. And I would agree, we need to have the aspiration to bring this into FE and HE, definitely. And in Scots, again, there is no qualification yet, and we're thinking about, you know, kind of innovative ways of collaboration, because numbers are a problem and we need to come together to make this happen. So, yeah, just echoing.
Is there anything you want to pick up on there, Ben McPherson?
No.
Thank you. Can move nicely on to Michelle Thompson now, please.
Indeed. Sylvia, I'm going to come back to you first, because we started to touch on this area. The bill as it stands has no provision for Scots in the higher education, further education sector. I'd appreciate what your view is of that and any further perspectives. Thank you.
As I just said, I think we should aim high, and we should think, put Scots on an even par with other languages that exist in this country and that are taught in this country. So I think we should think about that. And there is a real appetite among universities to include this. University of Glasgow has repeatedly said that, you know, they're aspiration would be to have a qualification in Scots, not just studying the language, but as learning the language and the culture as part of that.
Lydia, I know you want to come in here as well. Could I have your reflections? Thank you.
Apologies to you. I have no response to make on Scots specifically. My comments and the comments of my colleague were on Gaelic language only.
Okay. Inge?
I would kind of echo what Sylvia has just said, the importance of bringing Scots further into further and higher education, just to raise the I use the word, status of the language. Currently, Scots is, you know, there are Scots scholars, Robert Miller was here last week, but you can't actually, to my knowledge, learn Scots in a university programme, and it would help with the status, and again with the whole progression, what I spoke about, which I spoke about earlier, if we can start at primary school, secondary school, and take that into further and higher education, this carries a lot of weight with our young people, but also with their parents who make some of these decisions with the children.
And Dr. Munro, I know you may want to come in as well, but one of the clear reflections we had this morning was this is not just about the language, it's about a legitimisation and a cultural element of it as well. Obviously, Gillian, you're here from the Gaelic sort of side of it, but if you were advising getting greater reach and legitimacy and really pinnacling Scots in our society from your Gaelic, you know, what Gaelic has been through as a medium, would you think, or would you hope to see some provision for Scots in higher education and further education?
Chudin falcha chriav ir lehich de lisachag. Hanya mi feichgen cyson nach bieg solmarostig awn er son na björla gaelta gan betu awn an a siachag bogi gwysachag ma na chanan ach gwysachag cwsbarila cwjach ag sol môr haw gwysachag tron na chanan ach haw gwysachag cwsbaranila so haw gopar ir gach tuf gan byw ag sar ars dira hw filantach ach byw cwjach fein jolas y ligas lachtag ola mach gan y mi anion no y ligas lachtag ola mach y fi sgrifag llori hyr no y ligas lachtag fyd ola mach sy chegas gso cyrsonach gag yn yw'n rwyt gianaf ag yn tres ira y son biorla gaelta cwjach fyge uafasach ma fi ffaichgen liadach ag er yn chegas gaga ianaf yr biorla gaelta as na holhau yn y drasta mae'r eisiau'n planu'r hosig misio ag olhau yw'n egin as na hoch gyda'n fa P sound in the English language. Good to keep the Khan and Akatin or Berlogalta and Lubshin, Sukshin Tormochgo. Some is Munyahug and a big Kurshikin Masho Aun, Egira FECHE. Nu de bamische ochtjeg gerdoch en achromier de Vienna zulne galgijer achane lesachig zulne björlegalta. Zo amiketer als trischen aginjelach wisse lesachig zulne björlegalta kujach.
Thank you very much. Put that out while I'm asking a question. We heard a bit earlier about ESIL and how, in terms of the online platform you had, that was, and the clerks of HIC helpfully brought me up the link there. So I was wondering what the role of online and distance learning might be to support both Gaelic and Scots further and higher education in terms of that. Can I come to you first, Sylvia, as you're nodding away?
So we've already got a bit of experience
Open
through various courses. And when we started developing the public course, it has had about 47,000 people now accessing it. We really see it can also raise the international profile of the language. We've had people from 129 countries studying it. So we have a greater reach, and in terms of the teacher training that we're undertaking, we can deliver across the whole of Scotland, and we've seen it with the primary languages programme. We delivered as well to support the 1+2 embedding. You can use this as a tool to set certain standards across the nation, because everybody goes through the same programme and it's very accessible. And we're seeing that practitioners in the Highlands and Islands are joining us as well, because that's the only way they can get to this kind of learning. And an additional benefit is the great community of practice that is evolving through this course. And again, learning about other parts of the country, what's happening there, talking about dialects, again, coming back to that. It has so many additional benefits, which we are not even writing into the course, but they happen through the online delivery.
Lydia, are you looking to come in? Yes.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. To be brief, I've already spoken about our engagement with ESCOL, but UHI is one of the organisations that has a very highly developed digital learning pedagogy approach and connects learners in our area. But as Sylvia has said, obviously the big attraction of online and digital learning is the increase in reach and the accessibility for learners to access formal learning. I think it's important, and particularly post-COVID, it's important to set standards for high quality online and digitally enabled learning particularly kind of young people who've been through, in some cases, a very mixed experience with online learning during COVID, that they're not put off by the opportunity to continue learning, whether it's for languages or other subjects online. And we find that often in our experience that we have to explain actually what online learning means, the benefits of it, that it's not, quite often just self-directed distance learning, but it is learning that connects learners in real time with a lecturer and teacher at the same time, just delivering in a different way. But the opportunity for learners to be part of an actual community that just comes together in a different way through digital technology. So I think, as Sylvia has said, this is the way, I think, to connect lots of individual learners from different ages, stages, geographies. It's also an opportunity to work nationally and internationally. And but it does require best practice in order to be effective. It also needs to ensure that people don't fall into any digital divides or digital poverty traps if there is a lot of the provision delivered online. So people need to be equipped in order to access online and distance learning.
Thank you for that, Lydia. Very thorough response. Dr. Munro, we'll bring yourself in first and then we'll come to Dr. Burney. Okay.
More than time, I'm going to hug of a libre gig eraster rietanach is on fast and canning, Gaelic, agus Bjur Lagalta, Exol Moor has and DNA Akenya V Livrigig Eraster, Hashnervi Livrigig Fallam Eraster, is on a Moor and Moor and Leonich in a Nishbo, Masro Mish Exol Moor Samir Vian Havur Fichit Leona, Hashnervi Kurs Intriki, Immersion Kurs, is on Dunya Ekabel Uya Sahanan, Han you me kinjach my union bliana, femiachag, ach Ronishaw, ha do a scholar and irrebigunsachag, a boar fake and doof, bo och a richet, jiffer guchenen, agus harish eir coig jiffer continents, adavan nachil homors ashnigiri, ach gain hadavan shin fas, agus lefallam eraster, han you. Aniol Criach er yn adef dy sgolar yn esurigwt i olymachag mahan lwch gobrach acw. A tor yn y lwch gobrach ac yn cwtsiach i'r astar a cwtsiach yn ac yn y tsegysg na galeg fo America Jess, mae'r eisiau pler. Mae sy'n ffeimus yn fi asyn ddwlf ŵr a fi sŵpeltio a fi caniachag na ffeimalach gan eich lwch gywnsach chi. Mae dyna drifor time zone ffeimitws maniachag cymryd y sŵrigyn classic in a libra gig nur a hen nan dusk agus mae sy'n arall so chyda chyfi gra a sy'n y tyksyn chocwydr mach sa sio.
Thanks Dr Munro and Dr Burney.
I was just going to say I'm a hopefully successful graduate of this Somerset distance learning program, so I can testify to the effectiveness of a distance learning program, and I think distance learning, online learning can be an effective tool in our toolbox in delivering languages. And I think especially kind of speaking about eSchool, also delivering Gaelic to young people who can otherwise would not be able to access Gaelic language within their local educational authority. Although I kind of, my word of caution would be that we don't use opportunities like eSchool as a reason not to provide, for example, Gaelic language education in our schools, because especially for young people, there is nothing above a community, a real community of practice, rather than a virtual community of practice. And I think it's maybe different for slightly older learners, and we all realise the importance of digital technology, and it has a role to play in creating Gaelic communities, for example, through online media, and that digital learning has a role to play in that. But I think my word of caution would be that we don't just rely on this as the only means of delivering Gaelic medium education or Gaelic where there is currently no provision.
Thank you very much for that. That was an interesting response. The last question we have this morning is about how education is linked to supporting communities to use Gaelic and Scots in everyday life, which I think many of you will agree with. So how is that working? We heard from Lydia earlier about the Gaelic plan, working with creative cultures, heritage in the curriculum around the area. So is it an aim for education providers? And if so, how would that aim be evaluated? Who would like to go first on that? You're all the last one. I'm going to bring in Gillian Munro first, if that's okay.
More in time, agus fear you hastes hot all at your clinion gibble case down, me in and kel, either fallum, FEHE, agus koyashnach, or gun koyashnach, jehoun. Ha oves och kutramach gebin a kursichen. Harien, Rien, as Nakoyashnyakin, Le Ajin, as Nakoyashnyakin, Isurin, Nestuhin Shinelivrigig, Ha, do you have me a smuggle in adrenaline, Adolshi is semi fast luta, Kiddish, Ha, such a soul more Marishan player, a shinyas, Vashinis Manya Hagro, Wavas of Kutramach, Vien Sass, and Immersion, Le Buin and Ela, Le Marishan player, Hashin Sass, Le Duolingo, Hashinervi Gamor, Ekria, Skrivig, Nestuhin, Duolingo, Isun the Gaelic, Hashin the Nish, Hashin Afisak and Gabal, Un, Punga Hoch, Milan. dunya, clarig, fake and a jiffer hoyer snyakin, v clachgud nestuhin, a fisakin gibama le villain, you, gutrang, a gober vo lagalan, a gushakin, gushakin, a clachgud nestuhin shin, agus ha, classic and taik, re ein kuchak and snakoyer snyakin, Solmore Dijan Sas le speak Gaelic, immersed Nashanta, le taik munyahi, von in realtis, agus borsna Gaelics, MG Alaba, Kuchak and Sas, faravel programming gan Krulig, achastuhin ri ein, ansna koyersnach gan surigut klachgig, le klassichen de Genevich. I hokutr mach kuchak can be FEHE a kuchakug parentin, a gibble clown aha genu Gaelic as a score, and a fall on trivian Gaelic gaharage. Can be classic in noun, ans nakoyersnachen, is on taich humorua, gunuregai vivi meshnachal, glad a lenting, marishan player an oberdachi, eg parch and a fall on trivian Gaelic. A kuchak, wavas a kutrmach, can be shin. Rui Klassichen, ans na Koyersnachen, mar as an Ilan Skianach, as na Hilan and Sheer, and a Glasacho, Operain, etc. Gubishan Rui Klassichen, a Sundunia, a Hatukshin stoch on the Gaelic, no Egabel Began, ach Ek Nachil Mishnach, no Falachin Nachil Nakomasan Brinachka. So I really Kutermach, Gubishan Gamoran Sasachin, Kuchak Project in Nashanta, Martuber and Dulchish.
I'm trying to find an opportunity to, because we're a wee bit delayed in what we're hearing. I was wondering if you could, you spoke about so many different things that are happening there. How is the impact being evaluated in those communities of some of those programmes that you're discussing?
Magucha Gamburin Mesig Irbui Avina Shar, Avina Saramala, Agus. Maristrichke be slacht in Toshek Dunya, Agus Femiat, Arashianov, Oroval at the Ruxenshin, Shen Priavamas, V. Brosnachug, V. Kruachug, Barach Kluch Breen, Smashen, Shin Shosharutan the Bahor, Ganislacht in Toshe V. Mesig.
Thank you. Before I bring Lydia in, I know Ruth Maguire's also got a supplementary for you, Dr. Munro.
Yes, thank you. Dr. Munro, I wonder, we heard a lot about youth work this morning, about opportunities to play sport and be speaking Gaelic, to be doing art, drama, singing. Those sorts of things important for embedding language as well, particularly for young people. So it's not just about school, it's about life.
Gujara, Gujara, Femi Hularut, Avi and Sas, and Avi Kruach, Koyersnach, Gukinjach. Hami Gopar ex Solmor Sabrin me bikin me in Solmor Ashinya Kujak Irvi Gopar Marishan Plele Komen Gaelic Ked Eir Kimarasuringan and Leanrig de Goffagirin Barak Taik Ein Agasavichin Kalag Savi Vashinafalakin as Joy Peace Ramsachi Gibal Gamatrik Kin Fein Kin Mishnyak Eg Offigirin Gamatrikad Og Agus Gorofim eir Dunya Horch Colags Ked eir Coraman Treni de Goffiger and Hatolamach and a Koyersnach and Sagoper Le Buinen de Huan Agus de Yagerin. So I saw more Marunishimpler eir Buin and a Falum Hagoper Le Buinen Ela Etuction Gibble Fame eir Kushachatin Gibble Fame eir Tachartisan Ela Coraman. Nadere Markenbeeg, vi dunya vi chin call, agus a clachga gachanein. Shergo, Coram a hearts de chuid canila.
Can I bring Lydia in first, please?
Yes, thank you very much, convener. I will not repeat the points I've made earlier in response to other questions about this, but I think supporting communities is about not just supporting fluency or language acquisition in those communities, as far as Gaelic's concerned, but it needs to be also about community development. So the resources that go into community development need to be specific about community language development. And I think without that resource, And it's good to see that community language development offices were reinstated as part of the budget for this year from Scottish Government. But I think without that resource, it is very difficult to take forward that range of initiatives that that Gillian has spoken about. In some of the areas that my college supports, we have also serious issues with depopulation. So the language and supporting communities to keep the language alive is intrinsically linked to other efforts that support the population and continued population in those communities. So in US, there's a population plan, and I think potentially that could be seen as a blueprint for also supporting a Gaelic living communities. So this is linked to attracting people into those communities from elsewhere to settle there, but to provide appropriate housing infrastructure and jobs, and working in partnership, obviously, across the public and third sector, but also with employers in order to link job opportunities to language, culture, heritage, and the lived experience of the language. So again, I would emphasise, the all the efforts out with school, and not just formal post-school opportunities, but the informal opportunities as well as economic planning is really important in order to support communities. In terms of impact,
I'm going to have to move on to Dr. Burney now, with the interests of time, Lydia. I'm really sorry. Okay, thank you.
Okay, I want to kind of bring it back about why are we kind of enrolling children in Gaelic medium education. Really, our ultimate aim is that these young people grow up to become users of Gaelic. So in some ways, when we measure Gaelic, we look at like the number of people that are able to speak Gaelic, whereas maybe it would be more effective to look at the daily users of Gaelic, which is maybe significantly lower, and something that was touched on last week. But for young people, it is vitally important that they can see the language being used in their community. And it will be different from a young Gaelic user in Glasgow to a young Gaelic user in the Western Isles. But the opportunities to be able to use a language out with the education system, bring the language from something that you learn within a classroom setting and maybe only use within a classroom setting to be a living language through which you can live your life, have friends, do your hobbies, have your social life, and making that link between those two is, I think, vitally important. We don't want to kind of bring young speakers up of Gaelic who then do not go on to use the language as adults. And I think that's something supporting community initiatives is vitally important in promoting the wider use of Gaelic. And one of the measures might be to measure Gaelic language.
And perhaps in your remarks, which will be the last of the session, Sylvia, can you maybe round? We've not really heard enough about how it's evaluated and the impact of these things, but maybe in you might consider that as
I'll
well.
Try. It's a big responsibility to find the words. I can only echo what you just said. Okay. The Open University has just embarked on a big research project with colleagues from across the four UK nations, looking at opportunities for refugees and migrants to learn Indigenous languages. There aren't enough opportunities out there. How this can be measured, we can definitely follow examples. We have other languages taught in the community, and we can apply these measurements in exactly the same way. It depends who you're teaching. I think we have different target audiences, new speakers. Then we have great examples, for example, at Banff Academy, where we piloted our teacher course, who have introduced project-based learning with the pupils going out into the community and engaging with the language there through different subject areas. So intergenerational learning was mentioned. I think look at a range of opportunities that can really fit the needs of different types of learners or speakers.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you all for your time today. And the public part of today's meeting is now at end. Can I thank you all for a very interesting evidence session? And we will now consider our final agenda item in private. Thank you very much. Thank you, everyone.